Live and we're live. Look at this.
Hey everybody.
Hey,
we
welcome
are
internet.
Back on the air after Computex.
Yeah, Gordon and I are very sleepy, so Mike, we're gonna need you to keep up the energy, you know, real high for us.
You got the GIFs in there.
Yeah, I've got 25 ounces of coffee here. Sadly, it's decaf, so I guess I'll have to do it all on my own.
You know, I'm a decaf guy too.
Well, I do real coffee first thing in the morning. If I have any more, I have to do decaf.
Oh, got it. So that's your follow up. Mm-hmm. Is the decaf. All right. Nice.
Really? Wow. Decaf coffee. That's kind of pretend.
Still tastes good.
I have some decaf tea though right now. So
it's fooling my body into thinking there's real energy in there.
It's full of fake energy. Either way, we're gonna need it. Hello. Everybody, it says we're live. Gordon, oh, we got two red shirts today. I didn't wear my red shirt, so
with lighting, it's just terrible with this.
Yeah, we got all the friends of the show. Davina, hello. Recycled, hello. Dave's not here, man. Tristan, Matthew Lang, what's up, birthday boy Matthew Lang? Boria Zero, Travis, what's going on? Lewis Law, hello. We got all the cool kids. It was fun that some people got to catch us live from Taiwan that can't usually catch us live. And then there were some people that stayed up really late or woke up really early, I guess. We had some East Coasters that came in. That was fun.
Wow. Huh. East Coasters. So that would have been
middle
of the night?
We started at like 3 p.m. So I'm not good at math, but it was yeah, early morning.
You said in the recording it was around like 12 or 1 for your local time, so that would have been 3 or 4 for East Coast.
Okay. Yeah, that's what it was. Hello. Richard Sean says it pinged him after midnight.
Oh.
So
midnight's not too bad.
Ziv said it was 3 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. So cool. All right. Yeah, we gotta keep our energy up, Gordon. We're the jet lag hit us hard.
Yeah, it's really hard coming back this direction.
Ooh-wee.
I'm ready to go to sleep right now again after waking up.
I know. I'm ready for nap time. Maybe we should just stream us napping. Would that be fun? Just a full nerd nap time.
The bad thing is it really was that, like, I was waking up at 4 o'clock in the morning until the day before I had to come back. So it really was like typical, right? It finally catches like, oh, I'm off. I've caught up to the time zone, but now I have to get back on the plane. So
yeah. It's an uphill both ways situation.
Sure. I wonder if it's easier for, I don't know if there's a youth thing or just simply some people's, you know, clocks can take it, but there's no way. I could never do like international travel all the time. It would kill me. I don't know how people do it.
Yeah, like Dr. Ian Cutress. He's jet setting around like a jet setter.
Yeah, I said he put in like 40,000 miles or something like that. That was a lot.
Yeah, that's wild. And Willis is still in the chat. He's up.
Hello.
He's up right now.
And you got that, you know, there's new emojis week or whatever. I haven't figured out how to download it though, because I can't. The application. So if you're seeing the stream and you're seeing the little GIF things, we get 4 GIFs a week.
And Ian says they're distracting. This is how we stay relevant with the kids nowadays. We just have our stream full of little animated GIFs.
I thought you were doing that with the TikTok dances that you recorded.
Yeah, pretty much.
They're pretty. They're. I mean, again, so if you don't know how we did this, we went into a scanning booth. They scan your body. You stand still. It scans your whole body. You're surrounded by cameras, and then it digitizes it and turns it into GIFs that they crank out. Or even cooler, there's a VR app you can insert yourself into scenes with. So
yeah, very fun. I did get that notification that we have 4 more free ones to snag, but I have not done it yet. So
what's the name of the company again? We should give them. It's
my emoji.
Unfortunately, I think the only existing booth that I know of is in Taiwan. Hit the shopping mall.
Also, it was the app's all in Chinese, so.
Yeah, so we have no idea what it even says. So I'm just kind of going from memory, and I'm kind of afraid like one of them is going to be delete everything. No, I don't know. So
yeah, don't do that. Also, if you could turn down your mic just a little bit, Gordon.
Yeah, let me see if I can do this from the.
But yeah. Oh, what's up, David Richards? Ruru 2, yes, this looks like my MySpace, for sure. And Ziv says we're advocating for ADHD. Don't worry, it's not going to be on the whole show. And Elena is going to join us midway through. She just had some stuff going on. Let's see if she is on the message yet. So.
One click down.
Cool. All right. Sweet.
Yeah, so we'll be discussing Computex and kind of like, you know, 1 week later kind of view. Apple IVR, and then, of course, the fall CPU stuff. Not a lot on the fall CPUs, but looks like it's coming from, from some companies.
Well, and yesterday we put up that interview with Wendell about the potential Meteor Lake, what Meteor Lake could be. So.
Yeah, and then also what 14th gen could be. Well, it depends on what the meaning of 14th gen is, right? So
we'll see. Maybe our video about will we get one more generation in the same socket is going to actually come true. So
yeah, although not in a way that I think people would want, but who knows? Who knows? We don't know. We'll talk about it later, but you know, Wendell has some tantalizing ideas. I'm always bracing myself to be disappointed because, you know, minimum effort is usually what you get. So I'm hoping if I expect that, then I would be pleasantly surprised if one of the hopeful, I don't want to say predictions, but one of the hopes that Wendell has for what we could see out of 14th gen on LGA 1700 could be quite surprising.
We will see. We will see indeed. Let me do one last thing before we start. Okay. Yeah, I do have that on. Okay. And Gordon, if you could turn down your mic just a little bit more. Sorry.
Even more. Okay.
Are you sure your automatic gain control is off in Zoom?
Yep. Yeah, it's off. Let me go down. I could also crank down the microphone itself. Let me go.
Just do it in the Zoom. It's fine. Just a little bit.
Test. How's that?
How's that, folks? How's that, folks?
Good.
And oh man, Kara, we did not check out Streetcom's new case, but that looks awesome. One thing Streetcom did have, which I tried to immediately buy, but it's not available yet, is these little kind of like analog VU meters, but they're digital, so you can have the little readout display. I can't remember how they connect, but they're like little boxes that you can set up, kind of like dashboard dials, and you can change the little screen to be whatever you want. They had a demo of like VU meters and things like that, and I was like, yes, I will be buying a fistful of those.
Where does it go? So it's a digital VU meters on a case?
No, it was like an external thing, kind of like how you mount like a little thing in your car. Like that kind of size, you know.
Ah, got it. Interesting.
Cool.
Yeah, the cases are going with all digital glass then. That's kind of cool and expensive, but neat.
Oh, yeah, and the Streetcom, the one I think they're talking about is the one that had the all-passive cooling, which was...
Oh, yeah. Interesting, like, 30-degree mount for the motherboard. And it was.
Yeah, it looked interesting. We did not check it out, unfortunately.
Oh, yeah, no. Computex is a really good case show. There's a lot of cool stuff there.
Speaking of Computex, I guess we should get going.
Are we ready to do this? And by the way, Lena will be here later, so.
Yeah, so let me get my intro ready, and let me bring up the ad read. So, all right. Gordon, you ready?
Yep.
All right, here we go. This episode of The Full Nerd... This episode of The Full Nerd is sponsored by Silverstone, the leader in small form factor power supplies for over 10 years. The SX1000R Platinum is the company's SFX 12V 4.0 update to the pioneering SX1000 Platinum released in 2020. It now includes the Gen 5 12-volt high power connector, features ATX 3.0 performance updates, and runs quieter. Pick up the SX1000R Platinum today and give your small form factor PC the power supply it deserves.
In this episode of Full Nerd, Computex Roundup, Apple does VR, and fall CPUs are coming. Welcome to episode 260 of The Full Nerd. I'm your host, Gordon Mong, with Michael Kreider.
Howdy.
Elena Yee is a little late, but she will be here. I'll say hi for her. And Adam Patrick Murray is controlling the vertical and horizontal.
Hello. Gordon and I are both very tired from the jet lag, but we're here. We did it. We made it back successfully. Unfortunately, my pilot on the way back decided to fly right through the typhoon, and so I had like probably the bumpiest ride in an aircraft I've ever had in my life, and that was... It was white knuckle for a while.
Really?
Ooh-wee. Yeah.
You know, I normally actually enjoy the turbulence sometimes because it's kind of cool. Like a, you know, it's like a.
I think you're the first person I've ever heard say that in my entire life.
I know, right? Yeah.
No, I normally do. Right now, with my constitution, I probably would not enjoy it. But honestly, I do think it's kind of fun because it's exciting. It's like, you know. You're in the dropship from Aliens or something going down.
Yeah, pretty much.
The dropship fall out of the ship, though, if it's in space?
That's why it's called a dropship.
It's low orbit, maybe? Just some microgravity? I don't know.
It seemed like
there's gravity on the planet.
Well, but I just think, like, if you actually... So if the ship actually dropped free, it would, like, slowly fall out and kind of... The maneuverability of Space 1999, you know, like, oh, is anything happening? But the thing definitely seemed like it was pretty fast. Yeah, so we're already talking about aliens already.
speaking of aliens, we saw a couple cool aliens-themed cases at the show. That was pretty awesome. But yeah, Computex, we made it back. We did talk about a good amount on our live stream. Thanks, everybody, for hanging out in the live stream. It was cool to see people that we usually don't get to see live hang out. And then there were some people who were up really late or early to watch us. So thanks everybody for hanging out. So we talked about some stuff there. We had special guests, whatnot. But I want to hear Mike's take on Computex because you were at home, so you got to see everything from a distance. How did you feel like Computex went?
Well, my assigned duties as far as the show was mostly writing up the coverage that you guys did video for so we could put it on the site in, you know, kind of a compartmentalized way. And my takeaway was I really enjoyed the War on Cable stuff, especially the live correspondent report that Gordon did with a bunch of sound effects in the background.
I was surprised that not many people, like, I thought there was going to be a lot of comments on that video of people being like, oh, this is Gordon's new persona he needs to have for the rest of the videos, but
that was fun.
Yeah, it was fun.
I mean, as somebody I don't really like RGB in my builds. I don't like the tons of little tiny screens they're putting into everything because I like my computers to look like tiny little refrigerators. So just a focus on getting everything as clean and tidy as possible once you close up that case. Man, I cannot get that soon enough. So yes, I'm loving that trend.
Wait a minute, so you're saying you want, like, no windows, or you're just...
I don't have windows on any of my builds, because the wiring inside is... I'm ashamed of it. If they can clean all that up, like, before I get closed, so I don't need, you know, $60 worth of extra cables to make sure everything's long enough to get to the back of the case, I'm all for that.
Yeah, and, you know, good cabling takes a lot of work, so mm-hmm. Not everybody is into it, so I could see the appeal of just... shutting the door on it and not worrying about it. The thing that got me, though, is it's funny how You know, the vendors don't talk to each other. They don't tell each other what their plans are, but somehow they all seem to arrive at the same spot.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, it's really fascinating because it felt like everybody was pushing, you know, convenience of wiring, you know, clean wiring, and making it far more accessible to even, you know, people who are inexperienced builders. And that was from at least five vendors, and there were probably even more vendors that were pushing it. So it was really kind of a... It is. It does feel like they all got together, even though, you know, they don't do that, because how stupid would it be to tell your competitors what you're doing? So,
well, I think if we're going to pinpoint a beginning for this trend, it's got to be Gigabyte in 2022 CES with their, well, not CES as such. They announced it and they released it. It's their Project Stealth with all the backwards facing cables, and actually made a retail product out of it, although it's a terrible deal to buy a case and a motherboard and an out of date power supply just to get that system going.
Yeah, and the thing is, that is actually as much as the coordination isn't always there, that is the one place that I do think they need to coordinate, because we do need to have Gigabyte, MSI, and ASUS kind of all get on the same page about where the cutouts are to enable the reverse connectors.
Right.
And then hopefully have enough motherboards that support reverse connectors that it can form its own little ecosystem to make it viable, because, you know, one of the real problems with the reverse connectors, especially the more radical ones, like the ASUS one that actually has a graphics card that has powered off the motherboard, is if, as a consumer, you really don't want to buy into it if you're looking forward, because if it goes nowhere, you're basically left with nothing. You dump the board and the GPU, because it's just like, these are two things that will only work with each other. So it's, hopefully they all kind of get on, at least agree to the same keepouts and the same cutouts in the back of the cases.
Because at least the Gigabyte GPU, the Project Stealth one, I think it was a 3070. I can't remember what model it was.
It was, yes.
Yeah, the connectors were on the back, so they were still the standard connector. So even if you wanted to put that in a different case, usually most cases have a cutout somewhere around there. Like you didn't have to have like a special cutout for the GPU necessarily. So
it's still less compatible, because if your chassis doesn't work with it, you're stuck with nothing. So,
yeah. Well, but definitely not the ASUS one. Like like that one doesn't have any wires at all, which is cool, but at the same time, you can only use it with that one motherboard right now. So,
and for people who don't know, you could watch our video, but the concept is it's powered off the motherboard. So there's actually a little, you know, card edge that slides into the motherboard and powers the entire video card without having to plug in 12-volt high power or plug in any 8 pins. Of course, you still have to plug it into the back of the motherboard because the power is going through the motherboard. But it is a more radical approach than the other takes so far.
Yeah, I don't think it's quite I don't think it's quite settled down yet in terms of where we're going with all that stuff. But hey, it's innovation, right? I mean, you always talk about we need to leave ATX behind. This is kind of a step in that area, right?
Yeah, hey, if you want to hop on this trend and you get desperate and your case isn't compatible, you can always just go in there with the Dremel tool, just cut out a big hunk of it, throw a little sandpaper on there, you're ready to go.
There you go.
Yeah, and that's why I think people, if you take the least radical approach, it's going to be a lot easier. So with the Project Stealth and also the Project Zero, or the MSI one, right? It's fairly easy to implement on any case by just cutting out the back of the case. So it's not that difficult to do. So...
And
it's just good.
And most of them should still be compatible with standard cases, I think, if you can get a little space in there.
It might be tough. It's just that, you know, this is the reason why I think small form factor builds are for advanced users, because you do have to pick your components carefully to make sure it works. You can definitely get things that just don't fit in small form factors with these reverse mount cases. You're going to, if you try to move it to a different case, there's a good chance it's just not going to fit. Like if you have a very narrow case, it might not work. You might have to use angle adapters. So it's tougher.
I also, I mean, we've yet to build with one. I'm still curious to get some of the parts in to try to build with one, because, like, I don't know about you guys, but for me, like, I like to do most of the work on the motherboard outside of the case first. But that might be weird to have the connectors on the back to do the work outside of the case. You know, I'd almost worried that it would, like, put some weird pressure on it if I'm, like, trying to push something down. So maybe it makes more sense to do that work inside the case on those kind of systems. I don't know. I'm curious.
I don't think it's going to change it too much. You shouldn't be putting that much pressure on the board anyway, because...
I mean, when you're slotting those RAM sticks in, like, you're putting pressure on it, so.
Yeah, a little bit, but if you're going to put enough pressure to crack the PCB, you probably should have bought a pre-built anyway, so I don't think it's going to radically change it too much.
I don't think it's going to crack the PCB. I'm just thinking the connectors are only on two edges, not the other edges, so there's definitely, like, an inherent wobble to it. It doesn't lay flat like normal motherboards, so.
Yeah. As long as the standoffs are okay, I think it'll work.
And it's a pretty minor, you know, change. You know, we say that, but every time you have a change in how you build with how you've been doing it for now two decades and more, we have problems where, you know, you don't plug the plug in all the way, you know, so there's all kinds of things that happen because there's just, people are just not used to it. So I see your point. It could be a problem, but once people get used to it, it's not bad. I'm interested in it because I do think you basically build the machine, you plug in the power and back, and it's going to look super clean. Whereas if you're kind of lazy, you don't want to bother with it, it's not going to look nice. But this will look nice for 99% of people who use these reverse connectors, it feels like.
Yeah. Also, Elena, I see you in the chat. You should come join the podcast. You should stop chatting in the chat. Come join. but yeah, I think the other thing too is something that Silverstone was talking about, how they needed to adjust the thickness of the case as well to adapt to make sure you have enough room in the back of that, which I think is an interesting thing too, because, I mean, case widths, you know, tend to change all the time anyway, but like in that particular case, you need to make sure you have enough so you're not just putting a horrible strain on the actual cable connectors.
Which was the one that I saw that just had the whole dang power supply behind there?
I think you're thinking about the Cooler Master concept. Was that it?
Okay. That sounds right. Yeah.
That's the one where this is another take towards making builds easier. The power supply is pre-mounted in the case and is plugged into the case itself. And instead of plugging your motherboard into the power supply, you plug your motherboard into the case using these smaller, the word is escaping me, but I would say dongle or just a small, what the heck?
I mean, it's essentially like an extension, like a real short extension. So you'd plug it into the case itself from the same side.
Yeah. That seems like something that would be a really great implementation for a small form factor design.
You know,
since they're so often paired with their power supplies.
Maybe.
Yeah. We've seen some cases that have already done that. NZXT has their H150. Is that? No, it's the one that's looks like the Xbox clone.
Yeah. H1.
Yeah, the H1, it comes wired with the power supply, and it comes wired up with the cooler. So there's precedent for it. I like the idea. It's been done before, actually, you know, 15 or 18 years ago by a company that's long defunct. But it's an interesting idea. I'm not sure it really gets you all that much. It does look a little cleaner because you're going to use these little, you know, tail ends to connect it. But it is also more points of failure in a way too, because you basically, you know, modular power supplies, as much as everybody insists is better, still is a weakness over, you know, having it wired permanently, right? So you have basically you have a connector on the modular power supply, you have a connector on the case, now you have a connector on your motherboard, and then you have another connector on the case. So you have double the amount of connectors. it does potentially increase the amount of failure points, but that shouldn't be a problem as long as you're doing it correctly.
Yeah, but still pretty fun. Anything else you saw from a distance, Mike, that you were like, oh, wow, sweet. That was interesting out of Computex.
Aside from the chips you guys were eating, that was, I love the little superstitions they have around them.
Yeah, my Gordon, I don't know about you, but all three of my packs of Kwai Kwai came in safe and sound. So
yeah, mine survived too. I was surprised.
Okay, yeah, I tried to pack them in a way so that it had like even distribution. So the chips in here are definitely like just smushed to hell. I'm sure I'm not going to eat them anyway. But yeah, I'm just glad they didn't pop.
Yeah, and for people who don't know this, the superstition here, I don't know if it's superstition, but the
it's like a good luck thing. I would call it more like a luck thing. I don't know.
Yeah, it's a luck thing. Superstition implies that it doesn't work, but for all we know, it works, because if people are doing it, damn, it must work.
Yeah, no, we first heard about it at the MSI. We went to their factories, or their factory building, which is now their main offices. But yeah, they gave us one, and they say they put it on different pieces of equipment. I think it means like be good is the translation they told us. So you put it on there just to tell it to be good and operate well. So we got one from there, and then when we were at their booth streaming live, they had the AMD ones, and Mike brought this a good point up before we started streaming. What happens if I put this AMD one on an Intel system? Would it be good, or would it do the opposite? Would it misbehave? We'll have to ask somebody.
Because it brings you, you know, good luck. It's the same as, you know, players wear the same socks through the entire series, mm-hmm. of the World Series, right? So I would guess it works. It doesn't matter, you know. Well, it all works until it doesn't work.
Yeah.
I love the little tidbit that you replace it when it goes out of date, never having eaten it, and just make sure there's a fresh one there all the time.
Yeah, actually, you know what? Are there... I didn't look to see if there was an expiration date. There's something. Oh, yeah, 2024, I think. Yeah. March 28, 2024.
So we have to bring back fresh supply from Computex every year?
Yeah, pretty much. Oh, you know what? I did notice it says, since 1968.
Oh. Could we substitute it with Funyuns? Would it work? Would Funyuns work in the U.S.?
Well, I think only if you've got a gaming machine. Very specific.
Yeah. It's a potato chip shaped like a ring, and it has an onion taste. It goes really well with Grape Fanta if you drink that when you're in middle school or elementary school. So that's the way we did it, Grape Fanta with your Funyuns. The Funyuns might work. We could try that as an American tradition of putting the Funyuns on equipment to make it last.
I mean, you could try. It'd be hilarious. I think the people we talked to in Taiwan would be like, "What? Okay, sure."
I think as long as you match up the flavor of your chip and whatever the color of the bag is with your RGB LEDs to make sure everything's in sync. Got to get the cool ranch if you got those blue LEDs going.
I'm surprised though. You have to replace it with a fresh supply though, because that kind of feels like the company that makes that product is somehow started this like, oh, it's a tradition. Really? You know, they just went around and spread that, and then everybody does it because they started it. Like, that means everybody has to, if you run like if you're like Amazon and you've got this like massive, you know, data center, you've got to buy 50,000 of those bags of Wagwai to put on your servers, you know, and every year, like, what's this cost? So like $500 for like snacks? Oh no, that's not for us. It's for the computers. Like, what? Are you crazy? So, yeah,
pretty much. For those asking, it's Kwai Kwai with I think it's with a K, not a G.
Really?
Huh. I think so.
I think it's Guai with a G, but because that sort of somewhat translates into Cantonese a little bit. So
really? I don't, yeah. But, anyway,
we'll have to ask Joshua from MSI. He's the one who clued us in on this. Unless he's like, of course, it could be just like they're just messing with us too. Like, oh, this tell these people some dumbass thing.
Actually,
like,
you know what? Crazy. You're right. Both bags we got from MSI. Maybe MSI is just like pulling our leg.
Just pulling it. Yeah, just pulling it. I don't think they are, but that would be hilarious, right?
I mean, they've got AMD branding on the bag. There's got to be something for that.
It's an elaborate ruse, right? You know, so there's other trends too that I think are worthy of talking about out of the case kind of like building thing.
Please.
And unfortunately, because our schedule got so jacked up, but we didn't see the height version, but Corsair has its IQ Link, and then Height has its Nexus, and that is basically different takes on one cable for them all. What do you guys think of those?
Yeah, Mike,
I think that falls into the same category. I'm really excited about it, just making things easier and more streamlined. I wish it was USB-C. I don't see any reason that it couldn't be USB-C for all the data and the power that they want. Because I think that's what Height's doing with all their stuff. I've only seen them do it with lights so far. I didn't see any fans that they had for their particular system, except they had a compatibility with the standard fan header going in. And Corsair obviously wants people to use Corsair equipment.
Right.
They said it was releasing later this month, and they haven't said prices, but somebody somewhere said it was going to be approximately 10% more expensive than their standard stuff, which sounds like a pretty good deal to me as far as this additional functionality goes.
No, 10% more than their high-end stuff.
Right.
I would assume so. Which isn't that bad.
I mean, but still going to be expensive.
The high-end is expensive already, so it's not like going to be a $5 fan kind of stuff.
Yeah, and Gordon, do you remember why they told us the USB-C couldn't work with their system? They had to have that proprietary connector.
Mostly for power, because they wanted to deliver enough power to drive everything as well, and they said USB-C wasn't really going to do it. I know you can do USB-C up to 240 watts. That everybody believes that it is more complicated than that. So. The problem with USB-C, and I've actually been talking with laptop makers about it, to get to 240 watts in a laptop is all low amperage. It's high voltage but low amperage, so probably dealing with it's basically not as cut and dry as everybody seems to think it's going to be. That could have been some of the problems with Corsair as well, and then also implementing USB-C can be more complicated because it is a Corsair, I think they said they have a serial and parallel protocols, communication protocols that they're using. They're passing power. And theirs is definitely more high ambition because they're trying to address each of the fans individually. Each of the fans actually have they have temperature sensors in them. So you could actually turn the fan speeds down on each of the fans individually, as well as control the RGB in a granularity that I've not seen before. So one thing is worth mentioning is they have this, is it called time shift? Is that what it was called? I can't remember.
Oh, time. Oh, dang it. I can't remember. It was a cool thing though.
Yeah.
I'm glad it showed up on video too. I was worried.
Oh, that's good. Yeah. So what they're doing is so they can have the fan. So you can obviously have it set the fan speed when you hit this button and you set it to, I may have this incorrect. I thought it was called time shift. What it does is it will then pulse the RGB, the lighting, not the RGB, but it'll pulse LEDs in the actual fan hub to make it look like it's not moving. So, you know, if you obviously are strobing the light, you know, just like a classic 70s strobe light. So it looks like you're strobing it. That LED, the fan itself looks like it's either stopped or moving very slowly because they have that much finite control over each of the devices. And kind of that's what they're shooting for is really, really fine grain control over your entire system, controlled over a single cable and powered over a single cable, except for any of the displays. The displays in the coolers themselves are too high bandwidth for the system that they have, and they actually have to plug in USB-C, which is, they couldn't build the system off USB-C, but for the bandwidth they need for data, they are using USB-C. So like the CLCs with the little displays on them are actually using USB-C on them.
Yeah, I mean, and honestly, like, I think, well, that one's easier to wrap your head around compared to the reverse connector one. And is, I mean, I guess cost-wise, there's going to be a little bit of a buy-in, but hopefully cost gets down if it gets picked up. But for me, yeah, like, it's not even just a visual thing, because like on my system, and I mean, you know, how many fans do I have that are RGB in there? And I got to wire in each of them individually. It's more the organization on the back end. It's not really a looks thing because I can hide those cables anyway. It's more the organization on the back end being like, okay, well, crap, how many headers do I have? Okay, do I need a hub? Oh, man, how am I going to power the hub? Like, this yeah. definitely simplifies. And I mean, they did say like, oh, this is going to be easier for people to first time builders and things like that, which in this case, I actually would tend to agree. I don't know what first time builders buying the most expensive fans you can get out there, but you know,
there's some, I mean, if you're buying high end, I can see it.
Yeah.
Although, I really do welcome either the height version or the Corsair one, you know, at least building some momentum for it, because I hate putting CLCs together. I mean, it's just so dumb because you've got each fan with wires coming off it for the RGB, then you've got wires for the power, and you've got like this massive trunk of wires that you now have to deal with just for your stupid cooler. It's such a pain in the butt. And it's just ugly. It looks like hell. And you can kind of, you know, cleverly hide all the wires, but it's just like, it's so inelegant. So to have all the fans, you know, connect together, they're connected magnetically, and then they pass the power and the data through the magnets. It's actually I honestly think I would pay the extra for it, to be honest, because it's just so much easier.
So
speaking of individual fans that you can change to address like hot spots or cool spots, did you guys ever manage to see the Silverstone CPU cooler that had like the fans you could pop out and add on to different spots to manage the total airflow? How was that?
I mean, they had it on like a wall display. They didn't actually have it like powered on a motherboard and like showing any like demos or anything like that. It was more just like, oh, look at this cool display on the wall. And it looked cool. I mean, I put my hand underneath one of them and it was interesting. For those who didn't see, yeah, it was like, God, it's really hard to describe. So on the CPU mount, it's kind of circular, and then it has little circular like attachments to the side where the fans were. So, and then those can rotate. So imagine if you're like, oh, you know what? I want to cool my VRMs a little bit more, and I need like a direct fan right on them. You just kind of move it up to the VRMs. Or, oh, you know what? I want a little more airflow on my RAM. You can kind of push it down to the side, and it'll blow air on that. I can't remember how many they had on a tower because it was like attached magnetically, but they got it, Gordon. I think it was like maybe 9 stacked up, and we're like, how many can you actually go? And they're like, well, we haven't tried it yet, but
yeah, the one they had 7 arranged 7. All the way around it.
Okay.
And it was called, let me find it. It's called the Ice Mist 420 ARGB.
Yeah.
So that's actually cooler. And then it has these optional, or not optional. Well, I guess if you want to stack more of them, but it has the extra coolers for the VRMs. I have a picture of it if you want it, Adam. I can.
It seems like a lot of people saw the video of it.
Yeah. Yeah, it was actually a surprise hit, I think, because people were like, oh, that is really kind of. Because I know the classic thing, though, is now people are like, oh, you like this? Because that's how a lot of these manufacturers are like, they just kind of stumble into it. I can honestly somebody go like, oh, people like the auxiliary fans mounted around the water block. So now we're going to actually mount additional fans, or maybe make it look like flowers, or just all these other things around your water block to ostensibly add airflow to your motherboard VRMs. But mostly is there because people just like the looks of it, right? So,
I mean, it does look like a cross between like a quadcopter drone and a modern art installation. So it's very striking visually. You can't beat it.
I know. I mean, that is one of those things where I think, you know, you get the response from consumers and they're like, oh, let's run with it. So now I could see, honestly, you know, from the factory, this thing having 4 or 5 different fans on it so you can swivel them around or I mean, honestly, stupidly, I say stupid, but why not have them motorized?
That's exactly what I was thinking.
Oh,
like, put
no.
sensors on your motherboard. Where do you need the coverage? Have them move around dynamically.
Yeah. Or, I mean, you could build some AI intelligence into it so it blows the VRMs. You could just have the thing just continually move around the motherboard, right? So you have 4 of them and they would just spin around the water block and like, oh.
That'd be funny. There's probably not enough clearance to for the top of the GPU if you have the GPU in the top slot? Like, because we didn't see it in a system. So that was the one thing I wanted to see was like, okay, how does this actually look in a system? Because I have a feeling like it actually might be more cramped than we're expecting. But
well, you could have them, you know, like windshield wiper blades. Like they would, you'd have two of them and they would just slowly do this pattern back and forth. There's just kind of crazy things you could do with it. But I mean, most of the things people are doing in their PC are 90% looks. So, and that's the kind of look that you would like, right? Because that's like, it's like people got like when CyberPower has that breathing case, it's like, oh, that looks really cool, right? So maybe that's the next thing is cases with active movement where the things are, you know, mechanically moving on their own. So
that would be fun. Well, a wild Elena appears. Hi, Elena. Oh. Happy Tuesday. Oh, you're muted in Zoom. It happens. Oh, nope, still can't hear you. That's okay. Live troubleshooting.
It's the ritual you go through every time you connect.
Also,
I swear, headset is so jealous of my dedicated mic that whenever I turn it on, it tries to wrestle back control over input.
Yeah, no, that happens. And if you can give me a little more on your mic, please.
How is this?
New Tech was asking, did you see any case with the diorama in it somewhere? I don't know what that is. Diorama? I'll have to look it up.
A diorama is usually like a little scene. Yeah. So it could be a reference to one of the cases that were just like, or builds that were just like crazy built out and had like a whole little story it was telling.
Yeah, there was one. Oh man, I can't remember. Was it the Be Quiet? No, I don't think it was Be Quiet. One of them had a case that had a World War Z setup, and it was like very intricate. It wasn't just the case itself; it had like a whole like scene in front of it. That was pretty crazy. Willis got a lot of footage from case mods, and when he gets back, he's gonna cut together a little short of like some of the coolest case mods we saw. So look forward to that.
Now there's a reason to route all your cables to the back of the case, so you can put an entire like 40K scene of miniatures inside with nothing to obstruct them.
Sure, someone thought of that already.
Oh, Endermax, thank you, Travis. It was Endermax. Yeah. No, it was fun. Well, welcome, Lena. I'd ask Mike, and I'll ask you. Sorry. From a distance, what did you see at Computex that you were excited about, or just overall, how do you feel about the show?
It was a little muted, I feel like, this year, just because we didn't have any like huge major announcements from one of the, you know, big three companies. But I actually liked it in a way, because I felt like it put more emphasis and focus on some of the cool PC building things that were coming out of the show. I really like that some of the trends we've seen in earlier years, they are now moving on to iterating on that and making things even easier to, you know, make the aesthetic build of your dreams, right? So that you don't have to spend hours patiently cable routing or cable doing cable management. You don't have to always deal with a boring black case. Like one of my favorite trends out of Computex was that there was color. Like we actually got to see more components, cases, and Thermaltake's always kind of led the charge on this, I feel, but Thermaltake had some really cool looking AIOs, even seeing more white and silver motherboards, right? Like I think there was like an MSI one that it had these really cool looking, I think it was one of the ones that had the rear ports, and it had these really cool like silver plates kind of hiding parts of the black PCB. Mm-hmm. And it gives it just, I don't know, it gives it kind of a more polished, my opinion, upscale kind of look, a little bit more sleek. I find that really exciting, because a lot of these things, even 15 years ago, you had to do yourself. So case modding was such a big deal back in the day, because you really had to craft all these cool things that we're now getting to take for granted because a manufacturer is like, hey, we made this for you. Just give us some money and now you can go home and just immediately put it in your system. You don't have to take out the Dremel tool that Kreider was talking about and be able to hold it so that you actually cut things in a proper circular, you know, manner and then like have to file the edges and all that stuff. So for lazy people like me, I'm very excited by all this stuff. I don't have to go spray painting things. Like a lot of people will go and take cans of spray paint, right? And just like spray down their panels for their cases to get that color they want. And you still have to do that if you want like a very specific color. But there's some cool greens out there that I saw. There's that Cooler Master had some of the best stuff for my preferences. That Encore 100, that like tower, like that, like a mini ITX tower, they had it in bronze and this kind of dark teal. And I'm just like, Elena, you don't need 7 computers just because you want a new case. Like, you don't need that many computers. I probably will end up with that many computers because I want the case, but that's just my life.
And then of course the fractal design, oh crap, now the name's escaping.
Oh, Terra.
The Terra. Yeah.
Yeah, that mint green.
Ooh, yeah. That was pretty. Somebody in Discord was asking, the only review units I'm seeing are either black or silver or white or whatever that color is. Mm-hmm. Why aren't there more of the green ones? And yeah, I was this close to getting the green one in. They did send it before Computex, so I actually saw it beforehand. But yeah, that was really pretty. I mean, Fractal always makes awesome stuff.
Is it being sold in the mint green?
Yeah, so Terra is available. Yeah. I think it was kind of a minty green. You call it a jade, a light jade color.
I think they actually do call it jade.
Oh. Yeah. I call it more of a mint because being Chinese, to me, like the only jade that's real jade is like the deep dark green one that, you know, has had time to cure to that color. So it's available in that green, Gordon. It's available in white and available in black, if I remember right. I think it's just, so one of the questions we got on the Full Nerd Discord server was, you know, do reviewers get a choice of what color they got, you know, get in? And sometimes you do, but sometimes some of those like more fun colors aren't available when the review samples go out. So I understand why some of the reviewers probably got, you know, the white ones or black ones in. It also can do with photography, right? Like, you can speak more to this, Adam, but like having a dark case is really hard to show the internals. So a lot of times we default to white cases, not because we are like gaga about white colored cases. It's just that it allows you all, when we do videos on cases, to see what's actually happening in there.
Or a live build or something like that. Yeah,
mm-hmm, exactly.
But yeah, you know, but people keep bringing, in the chat, other things up that we saw, and yeah, it's like, even though it was kind of a more quiet Computex, I mean, there was still so many booths we didn't get a chance to go look at, like Lian Li, we didn't really get a chance to stop by and check out that new Vision.
Really?
Wow. Yeah, like, I mean, we were like walking on our way, and then somebody has stopped us to go check something else out. I did pop by the Montec booth. They gave me like a real quick tour, but I was also running to something else. And yeah, there was a lot of cool stuff there that we didn't even get a chance to see. A friend of the show, Ruch, who's asking any more anime themed builds like Eva and Gundam. I did see and I sent this to our old coworker Dan because it was one of his favorite, but Initial D, they had Initial D, but yeah. It was a mod. It was like a Tower 100 mod. I didn't see any actual anime like crossovers or anything.
Like,
but
full builds, right?
I mean that weren't mods. Yeah. That, okay. I think they're talking about like actual like product. Like
they had that like Street crossovers. Fighter crossover. They had a Street Fighter crossover at the Cooler Master booth, if I remember mm-hmm. right.
And it was actually well done for sure. Yeah. But I'm just thinking in terms of like anime. I don't remember seeing any specific anime ones.
The Street Fighter is pretty anime.
It's a bit adjacent.
Yeah.
At this point, did you see somebody sent me a link for the cat one? So apparently, like, there's a whole, like, the case itself has like the cartoon cat on the front, and they actually have a graphics card that's like colored in a way to suggest like calico or marmalade cat coloring. And I was like, I'm so glad some of these things never make it to the US because I would be so broke. I would be so broke. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, there's actually two versions of the case. They had
Oh.
a smaller version and a bigger one. I got photos of that as well. I didn't see the GPU
Oh.
though, but it was like people were surrounding it. I was just once
Yeah,
again running to something else and was like, oh, interesting.
it was really subtle. It's like white, but then like the fans, like think of kind of like Noctua, but instead of like Noctua brown, it's like slightly more of like a tan orangey
Oh, that
color.
is
So
cute.
like, yeah, it's pretty subtle, but it's cute.
I
So
wonder
just
how
look out for
hard.
that kind of stuff.
I wonder
Oh,
how
sorry,
hard
go
it
ahead.
is to. Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I wonder how hard it is to do licensing for these. To do, Initial D is a. I was introduced to that by my son. Like I have no idea what it was, but there's a but all the anime and all that stuff. For case vendor, you can't just simply throw the graphic on there and make it. You have to actually pay somebody to use their, intellectual property. I kind of wonder how hard it is to do that. And then I also wonder if it's really risky because, you pay for it and you spin it up and you do, say, I don't know, 10,000 units with that actual anime or whatever, pictures styling on it, and then you can't sell it. It's going to sit in a warehouse for the next 5 years. Like, if you can't sell it all, it seems like it is high risk. So I guess I can understand why, when you have thin margins already in the case chassis industry, you add an extra cost to it, and then you just don't know if you're going to really move them all.
I mean,
I
it's not even
know.
just the case though. Like the when ASUS did the EVA and the Gundam ones, they were GPUs, motherboards. Like
Yeah.
Willis's last build was had one of those Gundam motherboards, and they actually had two different versions. Like they had the good guys and the bad guys in Gundam. So it was,
Oh,
so
nice.
yeah. But I
Well,
mean, he it was a 10th gen motherboard, and he really didn't have anywhere to upgrade. So he was like, oh,
that's a
okay, well.
bummer.
Now he just has the motherboard. We were talking about ways of maybe displaying it or something like
Yeah, you
that,
just get an acrylic case or something to mount on the
but
wall.
do
I mean,
they do future versions? Like, was that the only one? Any
I
12th gen?
yeah, no, they just did I can't remember the chipset, Z490, was it? Something like that. But they oh, that's what it was. The Which is even kind of weirder. The good guys were the Z version, and the bad guys were the B version. So whatever the 10th gen equivalent of one. So if you're like, oh well, I want the features of the Z 490, crap. But only the bad guys is in the cheaper B, whatever.
That's what you get for siding out of siding with evil, man. Like,
Right.
you just get relegated to second
Yeah.
tier. I would say though, oh, sorry, go ahead. Were you
Oh, I
about to
was
say
just going to
anything?
say we did get two super chats. I'm so sorry. I forgot to mention two $5 super chats from a friend of the show, Joseph Frusky, and the high school that he teaches at. Good to see it. And it says, Gordon, what they say about the Star Trek red shirts. Please be careful. We need you around for a long time.
Scotty wore a red shirt though, so like,
Engineering and
was he the only one who?
command, right?
Command in
No,
the next
Uhura wore
generation.
red.
In the original, it was
Yellow, that's
engineering that
right.
was red.
Yeah.
Uhura wore red too, so interesting.
Comms.
She would be operations, I think.
Yeah, that makes doesn't make a lot of sense, does it? Security,
The expendable
comms and
ones, I think,
engineering.
is what they
Okay.
were trying to say. Oh yeah, and I forgot about the ASRock Z790 Sonic the Hedgehog board. I think that
Oh,
was
wow.
just the motherboard though.
For all the licensed products I've ever seen in this kind of thing, it's always based on something existing. So I think it's just a matter of a paint job and a little bit of weeks in the very final process of manufacturing, and they'll do what, maybe 1,000, maybe 5,000 of these units. It's an extra expense, yeah, but it's not so much of an extra expense that it's some crazy risk, especially if they know they're going to have a certain, fan base. Like, it's a safe bet that you've got some people who want to build computers who are also Gundam fans.
I mean, when we
Yeah.
were
They're
looking for
choosing.
that Gundam stuff for Willis, it was all sold out. Yeah. It was so, yeah.
I mean, they're choosing franchises that are huge. I would think more the issue is getting that franchise to agree to it as opposed to the other way around, right? So, I mean, they're doing Street Fighter, huge fan base. They've done Gundam, they've done Ava, right? So huge fan bases. Like, I'm sure if they were ever able to do it, if they were, like, doing One Piece also, like, that would sell out. There's, like, just huge fandom around these things. So it's going to sell. Honestly, what I am surprised they haven't done yet because of the whole upgradability issue, right? Like, eventually you're going to get off a 10th gen board. Eventually you're going to, you know, abandon this, but you don't want to abandon like your homage to one of your favorite series. But they don't do more motherboard covers, right? Because like an ATX motherboard is roughly laid out the same way, right? So like, why don't they do these like licensed motherboard covers that you can basically take with you from build to build? You know, and like they could constantly be, if depending, they probably don't have the wherewithal or like the energy to have a separate licensing department to create these things. But if they were able to standardize this enough, like you could have a whole like sub business of being like, yeah, like this year we're releasing special like One Piece, like whatever anniversary commemorative things, or like, well, One Piece is ending, so here's like some favorite things, scenes from your, you know, favorite episodes, like stuff like that. I don't know why I'm stuck on One Piece today. I'm just using it. There's just so many licensed properties out there that would just probably, to me, like sell like hotcakes. Sailor Moon, definitely a big one. Gosh, yeah, so many.
I think it's just probably 15
builds in my house.
You know, because you know, it's. I kind of think of like licensing like Disney. Like you could license like, oh, we're gonna make some, you know, rat poison or something, and you could license anything. They really don't care as long as there's a check attached to it mostly. So I don't think that's going to matter that much. I just kind of think it's like, how do you really balance the demand for it? And especially, you know, if still being stuck with 1,000 of these things that are premium that you paid for, it seems kind of tough for a case vendor, it feels like.
I think that's what we're saying, is that they're probably not getting stuck with them. Because they're making so little and they're picking properties that are so popular, but who knows? I don't know.
Yeah, no, I mean it just makes you wonder, because you know PCs are all about personalization, so I'm just surprised somebody hasn't leaned into the really just kind of like this customized IP kind of around it. You know, you can't get that from a lot of, you know, boutique vendors, but to get that from a case vendor would be kind of neat. I just don't know how easy that would be to do and whether you can really make money at it.
At least with cases, it's easier to have a case that can withstand a couple generations. Like if you're on a motherboard and you're like, all right, or if you have a 3070 GPU and you're like, okay, well at some point I want to upgrade that.
Well, yeah. For a case, you could at least do something like the old Nokia phones with the faceplate, where you can get a billion different kinds of them. I mean, most of them already have side panels that you can take off and that are fairly interchangeable. Just sell different patterns on that. Good to go.
True.
That was my favorite thing about, it seems like it's become more of a standard-ish feature, but you know how Corsair, when they launched their 4000D, 5000D series, and you had that front panel that you could swap so that if you could have a solid panel, you could have the airflow panel, et cetera, et cetera. I was surprised that, you know, manufacturers aren't at least encouraging a cottage industry to spring up around that, where it's like, hey, we customize these for you, right? Like you want a photo of your cat on there, we can do that for you. Walgreens, I just saved your photo department.
There we go.
You know, one other thing I want to ask you about, because it was a weird thing at Computex, and I don't really know if it's deserved or not, is all of the insane PCIe Gen 5 SSD cooling for motherboards and aftermarket. Like I saw, actually, I didn't get back to Gigabyte to do a video on it, but they had a motherboard. It's one of their Z790 refresh boards, which we can talk about later. But it had, and they've used this before, but it had a PCIe Gen 5 cooler that was like 5 inches tall. It was like, it was crazy, right? It was like the biggest one I'd seen until I saw one that was bigger. And I think Team Group has an aftermarket, you know, CLC. So basically, you know, a single 120 millimeter, it looks like a cooler liquid cooling for your SSD. And then just everybody, and then ADATA had this kind of crazy, weird tube-looking cooler. Just a lot of over-the-top PCIe Gen 5 coolers. And I think a lot of it's kind of driving people to go, like, to scare people to think, oh, my God, I really got to keep these things cool. But I'm not so sure you really do have to do it, because also I saw some Gen 5 SSDs that just had the little minimal tiny, you know, aluminum heatsink and a little, you know, 1.5 millimeter fan on it. So do you really need all this insane cooling that they're pushing? It just kind of a little bit of a weird disconnect for me.
It's called upselling, Gordon.
I was going to say,
yeah.
If you're going to spend that much on like the highest end components, so there's definitely going to be some people who buy the extended warranty, so to speak, right?
Yeah. Oh, you know, and actually the other thing that too that I is worth mentioning is speaking of easy ideas, and you know, damn, this would have been a great on video. So Gigabyte has a new, their Z790 refresh board. They've had a quick release for the top SSD for a while. So it's just you push on it and you can pop it off. But they had the entire plate, you know, typically for the other three or four M.2s underneath the PCIe slots. They actually have a quick release, so you push one button and you can take it off with one hand. Instead of the take four screws out, remove this stupid plate, and then try to figure out how to get those four screws back into your motherboard for the other SSDs. That was a pretty cool feature.
We saw that at MSI too on their
but that was on the top one though.
No,
right?
No, it was on the
what was it on?
The big thick one on the bottom too.
Oh, okay. So all of them too. So yeah, I mean that is just like, oh, I'm glad, so glad everybody's doing that. And the MSI one actually had, so they had RGB integrated into the Gen 5 cooler because that makes it better. But they used pogo pins to connect the cooler on there. So it would pop in and pop out without having to connect wires or to deal with any screws. It was pretty nice.
So this is kind of a random question. And I don't really know that much, unfortunately, yet about open loop cooling. Have you seen any like baby, tiny little cooling pipes for those SSDs for open loop systems? Because I feel like it would not be very efficient, but I think it'd be adorable if you just had like little SSD, little pipe.
You know, I haven't seen it, but it I'm sure that's on the way because people are clearly into liquid cooling things that don't necessarily need cooling. And I'm not convinced you really need that amount of cooling for these SSDs, but hey, this is an overkill hobby community, right? So people like the overkill just for the overkill.
That can be something that can be tested.
Yeah, but I also do think it's one of those things where it's not like you need it. It's just more like maybe they're piggybacking off of the narrative around it. Like, oh man, these Gen 5 drives are so hot. Oh, okay, well, crap. If the narrative is that they're hot, then we should offer something. So
yeah, because now people are petrified that they really need to cool these Gen 5 coolers. So we're going to give you insane over the top cooling because that's better. As a marketing aspect.
I mean, that sounds like a video you guys need to do. Just test this stuff out in the lab, see if it's really necessary.
Yeah, actually, we're in the middle of that. I'm actually testing a Gen 5 SSD, and we're going to hook up some external thermocouples. The data is probably going to match what we've already done with our first SSD, which was, it is better to have better cooling, but for most workloads that everybody's doing, it's inconsequential. Because most people are not sitting there and writing at 10 or 12 gigs for 35 minutes. It's just not something people are doing. So,
also, most people don't have PCIe Gen 5 drives. So, yeah.
Well, they will one day.
Oh my gosh.
You got to be prepared for it.
Who has time for that, though, when Gen 4 has dropped to ludicrously low prices right now?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody in the full nerd Discord server was saying that you could pick up a 2 terabyte P41. For like $80.
Wow.
Right? Yeah. Those eyebrows? Exactly my expression when I read that.
I guess I gotta go pick up some more of the fastest in class SSDs.
Oh, okay. But it was like, whoa. So your hoped for 4 terabyte cheap 4 terabyte drives may soon be in sight, Gordon.
I don't know. Wait, how much was that for the $80 you're saying? How
2 terabytes. Gen 4.
For Platinum P41.
Oh, that's pretty good. I mean, because it just keeps getting cheaper. I bought that Silicon Power one that was $75. And of course, I haven't opened it and I'm like, oh, I shouldn't have bought this thing. But because now they're cheaper. I mean, that's the best thing is when, you know, because, and this is the boom or bust cycle that we go through. When the RAM and NAND, the same people, right? When the NAND people go through these bust cycles and the RAM people go through these bust cycles, it's awesome because you can get it. You can now get all the RAM and storage you want at the best prices. And then, you know, suddenly we'll get to those boom days for them. And these are the times where you're like, this is pretty good, but you have to realize these people basically go from like making, you know, actually losing money by selling their product to making money. So when they're making money, maybe you should realize that, you know, they got to make money sometime. So don't bitterly complain about it as much as you do when you realize like, oh, maybe you should have bought that 2 terabyte drive for $80. What?
Careful. The internet doesn't like capitalism.
Well, I mean, it's just like you got to understand that industry has always just horribly gone through these boom and bust cycles over and over and over again, so much that so many of them have gone out of business. So I can kind of take it when they do their profit taking, because they got to make their profits at some point, because otherwise the other 80% of the time they ain't making no money, then they go out of business and you got nothing. So this is a good time if you have the money for it.
I do want a correction. So this is very confusing. I actually really don't like that Solidigm and SK Hynix have done this. The SK Hynix Platinum P41 is equal to the Solidigm P44 Pro. So the one that's $80 right now is the Solidigm P41, not the SK Hynix Platinum P41. Those aren't the same. So
sorry, I misread that then.
It's actually really annoyingly confusing that they do it that way. So that P41 is not as not as good as the P44.
I swear I saw something. Let me look in. While you guys are talking, I'm going to look this up, because I remember
people run into that all the time.
It's very annoying that they named them both the same that way. But yeah, the SK Hynix P41 is not the Solidigm P41 Plus. So anyway,
what was there anything else out of Computex? Were you from the outside looking in, were you disappointed there wasn't any big GPU or CPU news, Michael or Elena? Although Elena's looking something up, but Michael,
I am looking up something. Sorry.
I wouldn't say disappointed. We've had enough. We know more or less when stuff is coming out down the road. I mean, if you want just tons and tons of news out of a trade show all the time, then I guess that's fun to read. Speaking as someone who has to write it up, I'm okay with a less intense workload as far as covering it.
Well, thank you for making all the stubs.
Okay. Sorry, I figured it out.
did either of you watch Jensen's keynote about AI and our new future?
I think I was sleeping. I don't know what time that was.
Or just watch it later.
Pretty late. Yeah.
I caught a recap, I confess.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
What do you think of it? Because, I mean, obviously not that much consumer news out of it.
I mean, Computex, you've got a bunch of crunchy consumer news at the bottom of it, but then NVIDIA has always sprinkled in some much more B2B stuff in their presentations. What was it, 6 or 7 years ago? Every single NVIDIA show, they'd spend half an hour to 45 minutes talking about cars. Like, that's not what anybody is really tuning in here. Or except for, I don't know, speculative investors. And they're going to catch the press release anyway. It's really important for NVIDIA. That's why they suddenly boomed up in terms of their stock price. But that's stock market stuff. That doesn't really interest me. I guess it's great for their bottom line at the moment until the shift goes somewhere else. People were arguing about how, you know, they're not as concerned about the consumer graphics cards market. I wouldn't say that. They know where their bread gets buttered. They know that's a reliable market and will be for years and years. I don't think it's anything to be concerned about. People are upset at the prices, and they always will be, which is understandable from a consumerist perspective. I certainly don't like to pay more than I have to, but it is what it is. If you get really desperate, you can always, you don't have to run 120 frames per second 4K for absolutely everything.
And, wait, what? And if you don't?
What about you, Elena? Do you buy into, I mean, Michael's reaction is probably the minority view, because it definitely feels like the louder wheel is afraid that PCs, I've seen it everywhere, that PC gaming is being waved bye-bye to by NVIDIA. So, you know, Jensen actually addressed that himself. But do you buy into that or not? Because that definitely felt like a Computex kind of theme.
So I think my take on that is a little bit more measured, right? Where it's like, I think it's valid to be afraid that when you're such a small slice of the pie, they'll stop cutting it for you, right? But I also think that mindshare is a big deal to NVIDIA, because I mean, like, think about it, right? Like, they don't have to produce consumer cards. I mean, they make money hand over fist in the server space, right? But I think there's something to be said for the intangible quality of having the hearts of the general populace, because some of those people are going to be making decisions about what things to buy for their companies, like IT departments, right? So I think there's kind of like that little bit of that human factor in there, that I think it's valid to be concerned that this company who is making so much money won't have really any incentive to make things consumer friendly. But I don't think it's necessarily a case where we have to worry that the pie is going to start, you know, be sliced for completely other different people, and we're going to get left out. It's just probably not going to be a fun time for us, given that a lot of us still remember an era where there was a lot of catering to, you know, desktop PC gaming.
Also, I'll push back on you, Gordon, because I actually don't see that many people thinking that NVIDIA is just going to like stop making graphics or, you know, gaming GPUs. It's more that somebody in the chat said it good. Zodray said, I wouldn't say they're ditching gaming, but gaming is absolutely on the back burner. So I personally haven't seen anybody say that, like, oh, nope, they're just going to stop making gaming GPUs. It's more like, oh, they're doing all this other stuff. They'll still make gaming GPUs, but it's definitely going to be, you know, not their mind share. So,
but maybe that's a great opportunity for AMD and Intel to finally get their feet under them in a way that really puts pressure and forces kind of a situation that we see on the CPU side. So, you know what? It may be painful in the short term for some of us who are hoping to get our hands on more current gen stuff at more affordable prices, but we could be having a very different conversation about this in 3 years, 5 years.
Competition.
Yeah. And competition is good. And also, Adam, I will say I'm basing most of that on the headlines and the YouTube thumbnails and the quick reads on Reddit. You may say people don't think that's going to happen, but there's definitely people that are, you know, screaming that, you know, they're going to abandon us, right? And how else can you take a headline or, you know, a post that says they're going to abandon us to not mean they don't care, right? So
I personally haven't seen those headlines. So once again,
Let's entertain that. I think that's pretty ridiculous. But let's say it did come to pass that NVIDIA suddenly said, hey, we can make $100 billion a quarter doing AI. We don't need gamers anymore. What happens then? AMD and Intel come in and swoop up on all the price points that NVIDIA has abandoned. And you've still got that choice. You've still got companies that want to compete in that space, because PC gaming is still the number one space for gaming in the world, if you don't count mobile, and I don't.
Oh, fighting words.
Also, I mean, hey, AMD's in all the consoles, you know, that wouldn't change either. So
I was going to use my analogy here that I've used before. I'll bring it up again. I don't know if everybody's ever heard it, but it's I liken the average person, average gamer, for some reason, to like the ones that are concerned about this. I know Adam is like, oh, I haven't seen that. Okay, well, you know, I have. So
not that they're completely going away. I'm seeing people saying that they've got the eye off the ball, but not that they're completely leaving GeForce. You've literally seen headlines in YouTube videos saying that they're going to stop making gaming GPUs.
Well, when you see a headline that says, you know, abandoning us,
okay,
what
but
the hell does
that's
mean,
different.
Right?
I'm going to nitpick here, but that's different.
So
it's a little bit different because they can still make gaming GPUs and then just leave us in the corner to, you know, cry about it.
But, you know, as again, like Michael pointed out, like, you know what, you get off your gas here and AMD or Intel are right there. They definitely want to, they want to eat into that, I don't know, multi-billion dollar market for gaming GPUs. Yep. So that makes zero sense. But I mean, I know, I will say, I feel like sometimes it's like, you know, I've never been in a relationship like this, but I've seen it on reality TV. And that is,
oh boy,
you're in a relationship with somebody and they are just like, totally like, who are you talking to? Who are you texting? It's like, I'm texting work. I'm calling work, you know? And like, and then they just like this hyper jealous, crazy person that like, if you have any other relationship outside of them, like you're not the center of their entire world, they just freak out. So I just kind of liken it to that because I just think there's a big enough pie and they can do other things. And as long as they make competitive products that are worth you paying money for over an AMD or Intel card, that's the only damn thing that matters to me. Like if they can make other things in their business that make them money and that goes into whatever, to me, it's just like, I just don't think the whole freak out is really, it's just not valid right now. I'd have to wait till we get proof, right? And there is really no proof of that. It's just everybody just immediately freaking out and saying, oh, that's it, you know, and that really is kind of the whole thing that you're seeing in the internet. That's the automatic reaction you're seeing in YouTube comments and Reddit and everybody just on Twitter. And I think it's just kind of silly because who the hell abandons a multi-billion dollar market to their competitors that are ready to scoop it up? It just doesn't make any sense.
I think you might also be seeing the loudest part of this particular discussion that might not be the most accurate kind. Because if you're basing your position of what everyone is thinking on YouTube thumbnails.
Well, and
your Gordon Mo
and Twitter and
Reddit. Wow. Well, Carter just
Twitter,
coming
Reddit,
in here was
headlines.
Like, boom. There's some truth for you.
He's coming on
some
Gordon's podcast.
Some practicality for you. Gordon, I feel like what you've just said, to sum up for everybody, you have just told the entirety of the internet to go get therapy.
Not entirely, because I mean, clearly some people are like, whatever, you know, and again, I do think the vast majority don't even know. They don't even pay attention. They buy the card, they buy the brand they want, they play their game, and that is actually a very large part of people that buy hardware. And they don't know. They just buy this because they always buy it, and they play their game, their game plays. It's now slow, and now I need to buy something newer. And that is actually a very, very large part of the market that just does not get on Twitter, Reddit, and YouTube comments and just scream bloody murder all day.
Really?
So.
Really, to me, the more concerning thing, if hypothetically, if NVIDIA were to say, peace out, everybody, we think that our resources could be better spent over here because it'll make us more money, and then we're left to AMD and Intel to fill the, you know, the remaining space that opens up, I think people should be less concerned about NVIDIA just leaving and more about the idea that less competition means less innovation. You know, like, I feel like if the outrage is there or the concern is there that you're saying, I think the focus is slightly on the wrong part of the picture.
Yeah. I mean, it is because, yeah, no kidding. When NVIDIA is going to be able to make way more money on AI right now, you know, it's the classic, you strike where the iron's hot. So I imagine that's where, and we've all worked at companies where you don't get the resources you want. And, you know, and this is the interesting thing. We could look at many, many times before where a company thinks we've got a lock up here. Our competitors are basically there. Our competitors don't even exist. They suck so badly. It's really hard for your department to get more money, to spend more money, to put your competitor that is not even a competitor even further, farther back behind you. So we all work in those companies where they say, let's work on the things that we can make more money at. We're already making money at this. There's no point in slaughtering them anymore, right? So it can potentially, it could entirely potentially to them getting off the gas, right? We don't know.
Now, I think there's a legitimate concern from somebody that NVIDIA in a sort of mirror of a lot of the car companies out there who are just not making cars in the $20,000 to $25,000 range because they can sell everything they can build at $40,000, $50,000. Why not do that? NVIDIA might be in a position where they're saying, hey, we're selling every card we can make from $900 to $1,500. We no longer care about your $200, $300 card. AMD and Intel can have that market, can have those margins. But if you're somebody who wants a $300 NVIDIA card because you're comfortable with that system because you like their software, you're out of luck. And that sucks. But that seems like a legitimate decision they might be on the cusp of making.
I mean, hey, yeah. If you look at all the reviews for this generation, 4090, awesome. The rest down the stack, eh. So I'm sure they're looking at me like, well, crap, let's just keep making 4090s. Mm-hmm. Maybe they become a boutique brand. I mean, you know.
It's one of those things. Yeah, that part of the market is just going to possibly change forever, right? Especially when you're looking at APUs and what Intel has coming, you know, with this tiled graphics too. So it feels like to me, I think I said this, like that 1050, you know, like those GT 730 cards, those $75 throwaway GPUs, that entirely looks like it's mostly gone to me, given up to integrated graphics from AMD and Intel.
So anyway,
but yeah,
we should wrap up Computex because we're an hour in and we've got other stuff to talk about. Anything else from Computex real quickly? Or
I love this idea of flat pack cases. I think it's so cool. The idea that you're getting a fully modular case, because I feel like that opens up possibilities. And I'm very excited to see if this takes off as a trend and if companies are able to do some unique, innovative things with it. I'm hoping that if it does, it remains more of a niche thing because I do not want to IKEA everything in my life. You know, like I do want the option to be default to you get the case ready made.
Wait, you're saying you like the idea, but then you don't?
I like the idea. I don't want it to become the default.
Yeah, I think the way you do it is you make it the default, and then you sell it as a feature.
An upcharge? Right?
Well, no, because
Gordon,
it's...
That's no, what because, I'm afraid of.
Well, of course, it's because like, oh, look, you get to build your own case. Well, before you used to build it for me. Why am I paying you the same amount of money and I'm now building it with my labor?
Oh, that's what I mean.
Yeah, and I'm entirely, if somebody can pull that off, because the fact is shipping isn't getting any cheaper. And if you could ship, you know, 10 times as many cases in a container as you could a built case, you could definitely see some people go like, oh, okay, we need to do it. But then I think the good thing you can look at there, Elena, because it probably would become the default, is then there will be innovation around making it better. Because ideally, the first ones that do it are going to be bad and then it'll get better. And then somebody will like, oh, let's really make it. So like you pull the case, it's flat packed, but it's not 400 screws to put this. And like we've all built IKEA furniture. It's the worst thing in the world. It could be just simply like a fold, like a pop-up case, like those like instant pop-up tents. Like you pull this case out and it's like, and it just pops itself up. Right. So there could be some advantage there of, although you have to offset the savings that you're getting from flat shipping them to now engineering and making all that, the mechanical engineering to make it so you can make this case and get it at the same price. So
we'll see how excited I am once they finally announce prices though. So the one I have in mind predominantly is the Cooler Master Cube 500. But they haven't announced prices yet. It's not coming out till September. So they said, yeah, they're going to set it a little bit closer to that date. And so if this case is like $200, I'm going to be like, yeah, well, whatever. Okay. Well, that was fun while it lasted in terms of being excited about it. All right. Anyway, we should talk about Gordon's favorite topic.
Before that, I do want to thank our sponsor, Silverstone. Elena, do you like small form factor power supplies?
I mean, yeah.
Do you like using them, I guess, is the better question?
They're very handy.
Well, one of the things that we were talking about at the Silverstone booth, they were talking about their newest small form factor power supply, which is the SX1000R Platinum, you know, and it's got all the SFX 12v4.0 updates. And the idea is that they're like, now we're getting so much wattage in these small form factor power supplies. Like, it's wild, especially with the ATX 4.0 updates. It's quieter. It's got the 12 volt high power cable, all that stuff. Have you used a small form factor power supply with 12 volt high power yet?
Me?
Or built in a small form factor case.
I haven't had the opportunity to work with newer graphics cards.
It is actually pretty nice to just have one small little cable in a small form factor build going to your GPU, as opposed to 3 8 pin power cables. So that is nice. Gordon, you saw this power supply at Computex.
Really, really compact. It's impressive you get that much power in something so small.
Yeah, and they're using Japanese capacitors. So, they're
you got to have those.
Yeah. it's an awesome power supply. They did send one over. I do plan on doing a small form factor build. I want to do a build in the Terra. I'm probably going to use it in there. Mm. So, you definitely look forward to it. And thank you to Silverstone for sponsoring this episode and sponsoring some of the videos out of Computex. Always good to work with Silverstone, and I appreciate them helping us get to the show. So, anyway, yes, Elena?
I was going to say, I realized I didn't actually know that Silverstone was sponsoring this episode. Like legitimately did not know.
Okay.
I was just going to say, I was like, that's actually I actually have really enjoyed using some of Silverstone's small form factor power supplies. And it's super exciting to hear that we're getting to a point now where we can get such high wattage out of such a small form factor. They're not the only ones who are doing high wattage power, small form factor power supplies, but I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah. Well,
very nice to build with one soon.
Yeah, they're not the only ones, but they definitely are the leader in small form factor power supplies for over 10 years. Don't forget that. speaking of leaders in the tech space, Apple had a keynote. Gordon just choked on himself. Gordon, did you get a chance to watch Tim Cook? Kind of bring out all these amazing new technological features on stream yesterday.
Yeah, I mean, they're happy. I mean, they're proud because they basically finally dumped Intel overboard because they Mac Pro with a M2 Ultra. I don't even know. Ultra Max? I don't know what the hell it is.
Ultra, but, yeah.
And then they have that MacBook Air 15 that is, basically a big ass. I mean, they probably would bristle at this, but it's their take on LG Gram in a lot of ways because LG Gram is basically an ultralight laptop. Doesn't have, traditionally would have a discrete GPU. It didn't have a discrete GPU. It's just, I would call it the Chromebook experience running Windows in a lot of ways because you just want a big screen. You want to, you want that real estate and you don't really need all the power.
I mean,
this is probably midway between that.
Yeah, we have seen, laptops like the LG Gram. I know Lenovo had one where it's like a 17-inch laptop with pretty modest specs or not even a dedicated GPU because you're like, hey, you're not doing power stuff on here. You just need a big screen, lightweight. I actually kind of like that they did that. Didn't really watch the whole show. So when I saw that makes sense. A bigger Air, I could see people appreciating that.
Yeah, it's like 3.3 pounds, maybe 12 sub 12 millimeters, so extremely thin. I mean, a very nice, Apple premium prices, you get premium experience, so pretty nice. Performance, they're kind of, usual Apple-ness. They said it was 12x faster than the Intel-based MacBook Air they made. By the way, that's a 10th-gen Ice Lake. 10th-gen Ice Lake laptop made in 2020. They didn't compare to like the original M1 MacBook Air or MacBook or the original or the 13-inch MacBook Air because the performance uplift would not be that impressive. And I would say you could even say that 12x performance increase. Yeah, some things I can see it because you're looking at a quad core Ice Lake, but there's a lot of things where honestly it's not going to be significantly faster than that Ice Lake MacBook Air either. That's just kind of marketing speak. They did try to punch PCs in the face by saying it's twice as fast as the most popular 15-inch PC laptop, And I, you know, they don't actually say what that laptop is.
Yeah, okay.
They didn't say what it is. Is it 11th gen? Is it 12th gen? Is it 13th gen? Because it was only Intel they're picking on.
Is it a Chromebook?
And they also, they did say it was Iris, so it didn't have discrete graphics. It's like, well, how many 15-inch PC laptops do not have just some form of discrete graphics? I would say that's more rare because most of them do, because you're looking at 15.6-inch laptop. Most of them have discrete graphics.
Hmm.
So I have no idea how they generate the numbers. Twice as fast? Sure, certainly M2 is pretty impressive, some things. And there's also probably plenty of things that a current 13th gen or 12th gen would probably kick the crap out of an M2 into. So it's just kind of like, it's kind of crazy to me that they have the M2 Ultra, but I swear to God, it doesn't have AV1 encode. And even kind of crazier, it doesn't even have AV1 decode, I don't think, because it's basically using the same M2 cores, so, and the same media engine. Does it finally have AV1 decode? I mean, which is kind of nutty because, AV1 decode has been on Intel and AMD for a while now, right? So it is nutty to have a laptop and a professional workstation that doesn't have AV1 encode. And I don't think it does. I'm not 100% sure on that, but it's just kind of one of those wacky things that all Apple people will gloss over because it's from Apple, right? So, but the exciting thing, though, is the IVR, or whatever the hell it is. What's it called? I don't know.
IVR.
The Apple Vision Pro is the brand name.
Is it VR or AR, though? That's one thing I'm
yes.
not. Yes. It's mixed reality, right? Like that failed, fizzled Microsoft mixed reality thing they were pushing for a while.
Yes, it's that do? Plus about 5 or 6 years.
Well, the
not
thing
on
is,
HoloLens,
yeah,
but the it, ones that all the OEMs were pushing.
Yeah, it's mixed reality. It's not AR because you are still looking at screens. You're seeing pass through cameras, but you're not actually seeing through the lenses. So
it depends on how you define it.
Yeah, well, but HoloLens, you're still literally seeing the world. You just have screens in front of you that are projecting. That I would call that AR personally. Mixed reality for me would be the, oh, you've got the nice pass through, but it's still projecting cameras onto your eyes, like you're looking out into the world. You're not actually looking out into the world.
I thought it does, though. Doesn't it actually do similar to what HoloLens does and being able to place objects?
No,
it's full screens in front of your eyes.
Yeah, yeah.
Opaque.
See, we're getting confused because, yes, you can see the world. It'll pass through the cameras that are on the front, so you can see the world in front of you, and you can, I mean, the pitch was, oh, you're putting, you're putting objects in the world and you're seeing through it. I'm just talking about the actual optical layers. You're looking at screens rather than looking through the world.
Did everybody just laugh? Because everybody laughed. Like, when they announced the price, everybody just like, what?
The way they
announced the price is like, well, and how much does it cost? If you had to buy a television and you had to buy surround sound speakers, and then you had to buy the house to put that in, and then you had to buy the car to drive to your house to put that in, then it would cost way more. This is $3,500. Like, what the hell? $3,500 for this? It was like, what? Right? And it was just like, what the hell is like? I mean, I don't know. Like, why would you count buying the TV for that? It's just.
Yeah, no, I mean, that was silly. The one question I have is that they're calling this the Pro. Does that mean that there's a non-Pro version? Like, they're starting with the high end and they'll have a lower end version? Or they're just calling it Pro because they like to call everything Pro?
Doesn't mean anything, I guess. But.
I did wonder, though, if they will come out with a more entry-level pricing one down the road.
I think it's a very distinct possibility that they do exactly that because they know they're not going to sell a million of these things at $3,500. It's just not – Apple is not stupid. They understand the markets of this. Two or three years later, they could do one at $1,000 that doesn't have a lot of the fancy capability and drop and cut the Pro off of it and call that because – they've invested billions of dollars in this. They are in it for several years at the very least.
Yeah. I don't know. The price seemed like a non-starter to me. It's just sort of like, because they were definitely pushing very consumer-focused applications. Like sitting there, you know, like a multi-screen VR thing where you could like have multiple screens, high resolution screens in front of you. And that's actually kind of what I'm interested in, because at the price they picked, which is insane, frankly, I mean, maybe they actually have the screen panel technology to make that vision of being able to work on a VR screen actually usable. Because every time I get sold that line from everybody over the last 10 years, it's like having a giant full screen, like an 80-inch TV in front of you, or it's like having a great big giant monitor in front of you. And then you put it on, it's like, no, this isn't. This is so low res, it's horrible, right? So I am hoping that people who try it, and let's just hopefully they haven't sniffed too much like glue at the Apple event, that they're like, they actually believe it. Because I really hope that if they're really pitching this as do Excel on a large screen in front of you, if that experience really matches what you're going to get out of a 5K Apple panel, okay. But if it's short of that, it's just going to be the most disappointing thing ever. And we'll have to see. We have to wait for early feedback, early reviews. But, you know, I've been sold that line of goods by a lot of companies many, many, many times. And I'm sure everybody here has too. It's always disappointing, right? Those experiences suck.
I will say I'm not worried about the resolution, because I feel like even on the newer headsets, PC-based headsets, like the resolution isn't that much of a factor. I think what's going to be a hard smack in the face of Apple people who have never tried VR yet is the field of view. Because they didn't talk about the field of view, and when they, I mean, especially if you look at the commercial, that, you know, they put the headset on, and then all of a sudden you're just seeing the whole room, and you're like, oh wow, my field of view is just huge. I wonder what the field of view is like, especially because, you know, if you're supposed to be like, okay, well, I've got, you know, three big things that I'm working on, but the field of view is only actually this tight, and you can only really see so much at one time. I think that's going to be the more harsh reality. For people, and one that they just didn't talk about, because they talked about like the density of the screen even on the presentation. So I bet the screen density is going to be fine.
Really?
Yeah.
But you know what I'm talking about, because they say you can use it for productivity. Like, would you really trade your large 4K panel for it? Is kind of what that's the line I have to see crossed.
Well, and then it's hard
to believe that they have that resolution.
And they were like, just control everything with your hand. But there are some times where you need the mouse and keyboard, which just felt like a weird like in between of like, oh, wait, like, yeah. So also, some people are reporting that the battery life is only 2 hours. And you got to put that little...
I think they said that at some point.
Did they? Yeah. Okay. And you got to put that little pack in your pocket.
That's untethered. You can plug it into a laptop and get basically unlimited.
Yeah. I mean, but that's also just, I mean, yeah, I don't know, you know, who's going to be using it that way, especially when you don't, I thought it was like plugging in maybe to a phone, or maybe the guts, mm-hmm. the actual computing power was in the external little box. Cause it's like, maybe you plug kind of like the Quest, right? You have the option. It's got the onboard computing, but if you plug into a computer, you get, even more computing power. I thought maybe they were going to allow that, but yeah.
Well, does it have any onboard? Like, because do you actually have to have a phone or a Mac your productivity?
There's an M1 inside, so yeah, all the computing power is happening on the headset itself.
No, I mean the computing power for display, but can you run a browser on the device? Okay.
Yeah, it's Quest style. It can do standalone. And then it can also, I don't know if it was wired or wireless, but it can also talk to a Mac computer and you can pull up your screens that you're using there.
Well, what do you need the Mac for if you've got the screens and the computing in it?
Then? That's a good question, Jordan.
Because you're also going to have your iPhone and your Apple Watch and your earbuds and the whole ecosystem. They want you to have all, and I'm sorry, it's an M2 in it, not an M1.
Or R1, I thought they called it the R1 for this.
Well, they had both. So the mm-hmm. M2 does the processing. The R1 does the lower end management between the cameras and the syncing all the signals and stuff like that. So yeah. Anyway, we got a $2.20 Canadian. From Skeet Sayer, friend of the show, Skeet Sayer, thank you so much, said, why are we talking about Apple on a PC podcast?
because you have to, because the gravity well of Apple means everybody must talk about it. It's just like the movie The Black Hole. You just try to avoid it, you're going to get sucked into it. You got to talk about it.
And in fairness, what Apple does can influence what we end up seeing on the PC side, right? Like I'm sure you all remember when Apple came out and they were like, so do you like computers that have no ports on them? Because we have a laptop for you. And then what do we see from Asus and other manufacturers? You get a 12-inch laptop that has only one freaking port on it. So thankfully we abandoned that. But, yeah. You know,
I mean, I there wasn't too much hardware-wise or even software-wise to a certain degree that I saw that I was like, oh, wow, they don't do that anywhere else. I guess really the biggest thing was the whole scan your face before you put it on, and then it projects your face on the front or uses your face facial scan like during phone calls. Like that's the only stuff I, you know, was like, oh, okay, well, that's definitely different. Nobody else in the market is doing that.
Yeah, because it's terrifying.
Yeah. You
know. Yeah. They did a deep face of your face and they want you to use that with real people. Oh,
yeah.
I remember very specifically in the demo, they have the user wearing the headset, talking to people via FaceTime, three other people in this chat who don't have headsets, and they wait for 20 or 25 minutes in the presentation to reveal, oh, they're seeing this horrible digital corpse doll thing of your face. That is reacting to what you're saying and how you're moving. And the same tech is what they put on the front-facing screen that shows a digital copy of your eyes to all the people around you, scaring small children, one would have to assume.
Uncanny Valley much?
Oh, yeah. Ooh.
Ooh.
Yeah, you know, that's funny because NVIDIA was pushing that too as kind of what, you know, AI-based, you know, video conferencing. And I'm not sure any of it's ever going to go anywhere.
Like that looks so much worse, so much more disquieting than the Meta crazy thing of we're going to all work with Nintendo Mii avatars.
It's different, right? I mean, having an avatar versus like being like, oh, we're going to do a deep fake of yourself. Yeah, the tech is cool. I think the tech is cool for sure. But yeah, like it's gonna be weird. It's gonna be weird.
But is this where we walk in and ask like you were so busy thinking about if you could do it, you didn't ask yourself if you should do it?
Yeah. All right, I came on here to be the argument for the defense, and I'm very pro VR and pro AR, if not necessarily this implementation of it. So I think there's incredible amounts of growth for both of these technologies. I think the idea of you sitting down either in your home or your office to do 8 hours worth of work with a headset strapped to your face is never going to happen. Nobody wants that. Nobody, that doesn't solve any problems that anyone has.
Yeah. And that is, we are pointing out, as Michael pointed out, originally the idea was here is Michael is cautiously optimistic on the future of AR and VR. And I am far more pessimistic of it now, to be honest. So
I think it's a natural evolution of user interfaces. I mean, we've seen it from original text-based going into graphical user interfaces, going into mice, going into touch and then haptics. Every time you have a big shift forward, it gets closer to a much more human experience, and you don't have anything more immediate or human than having something right in front of your eyes, with the very obvious exception of people who are vision impaired. Apple understands that the potential of this, and I think that they're putting in all this time, all this money for a product that at $3,500 is not going to sell much, because they're waiting for the big shift. They want to be ready when we make that shift into ubiquitous, I think, augmented more than virtual reality. I always like to point back to the video demo that the Google Glass did that was not indicative of the actual real Google Glass at all. But the video they showed of this guy going through his day with augmented reality and all these incredibly useful and incredibly immediate ways. And that's still something I believe in and something that I want and that will eventually arrive. And I think that's the future that Apple is waiting for, preparing for, and hopes to be there to be the iPhone of that technology when it arrives.
Well, since Michael is being the pro AR VR person, I am finding myself forced to pour cold water on this and simply say, put your science fiction novel down. We are not going to get there. There is like, it's on the horizon. It's going to be on this horizon for potentially our entire lifetimes. And it just feels like every single initiative for AR and VR is flopped. It's flopped hard, costing companies hundreds of millions of dollars, if not $1 billion. And it's just going nowhere, man. It's just going nowhere. I mean, I say this as someone who paid real money for, you know, an index, a Valve index. If I could go back in time and tell Gordon to never buy that Valve index, I'd probably say, yeah, you know, $1,000 could have bought a lot of other things that would have been used more than 40 hours in the last 2 years we've had it. It's just not going anywhere. And I'm not sure that this thing is going to do it either. I just don't know if the appetite is here. And yeah, I know we are going to get there. I know we will one day live on Mars, and we will one day leave our solar system, but that may not be for generations and generations. So I just think getting people to put money down on this hardware now is just a hard sell. It's a science fiction novel at this point, and it just doesn't seem like it's ever going to change, because let me point out that at the end of the day, after, I don't know, how long have we had keyboards on our computers? We still have keyboards on our computers. Aren't we just going to get to natural language? Aren't we just going to speak to our computers and tell them what to do, like Star Trek, and tell them what to do? Sure, one day, but I ain't holding my breath for it, and I ain't putting my money on it, because it ain't going to happen, because these things are dumb as hell. They don't work. And it's just like a false promise. They get us to try to kick that football over and over and over again. And the amount of e-waste from all of these companies that have been spending AR and VR that I have, literally, that they've made and they've given up on and they work pretty cool, just kind of tells me that this is going nowhere fast. So, sorry.
Nowhere seems a strong phrase, though, Gordon. I'm, as usual, more in the middle of with these two positions. I think it's valuable for humans to aspire to something different, right? Like, we have things like smartphones and tablets because somebody, more than one somebody, but people were influenced by TV series like the one that is in your background, because they saw things like pads and tricorders, right? And so that plants a seed of, you know, what could be in our future? Like, I'd love to see this become a reality. At the same time, I think that if you dig back far enough in history, you'll see that people tried to do things that we now take for granted, but they just didn't have the technology at the time to actually make happen, right? And in that regard, I would agree that I'm not a fan of VR, and I think AR has more potential personally, but I don't feel like they're going about it in a way that actually would get it to get traction. Right, people buy things because they're useful. Like they do the thing that they're like going to do, and they do it well and consistently. So even if that utility is entertainment, right, it has to do it really well. Like, you can't always be making excuses for it or saying like, oh, if you just do this, this will happen. Or like, yeah, it only has 2 hours of battery life, but if you like make sure you set it on a schedule, like it'll always like, you know, work out. Like, people don't want that. Like, we're lazy. Things come up in life. We want it to work well and seamlessly, right? And so I personally am still waiting for the day where something like the initial HoloLens demo they showed becomes a reality. To me, that is the real value in something like Google Glass or HoloLens, any kind of, you know, virtual reality, augmented reality placed on top of our normal existence. But otherwise, like, I'm human. Like, I like tangible things. Like, to me, if voice recognition when I'm talking to Google Docs is not accurately capturing what I'm saying, I'm spending way more emotional energy and time trying to fix that as opposed to me just doing my standard, put my hands on a keyboard and actually type that thing out. People didn't adopt the whole like the touch keyboard from the Microsoft Surface as much because it just was weird. Like you just didn't get that tactile feedback the way you were expecting. You would miss keys, things like that. So there's like that hurdle to overcome. And until they do that well, I just don't think it's going to be more than something that allows you to dream, right? To like see a glimpse into the future that, you know, may stir your heart and make you feel like, yeah, like we're on the verge of cool stuff. But like here and now, okay. So slight, like small tight tangent. Yesterday I was driving somewhere. And I'm behind this car that very obviously is one of those like self-driving learning vehicle type things. And I was like, why does this censored keep putting on their left turn signal? Like there's like, are you trying like, cause like so far in San Francisco, they've all been manned or like they've all had a person inside to kind of override the car, right? And I'm like, are you trying to teach this car something? Because it's not learning fast enough and it is worse than dealing with a new driver. Like this is a kind of erratic that makes no sense to a human, right? And it keeps doing this weird stuff where like it would shift lanes kind of weird and then it would like put on the like the wrong turn signal again. And I was just like, I don't want to deal with this. I have to deal with bicyclists. This is like a part of Market Street that I don't want to be on to begin with. I've got like other cars, weird intersections, and now I got to deal with this. And finally it veers off into this other lane. And I'm like, okay, I'm gonna do that drive by, you know, the one we all do when we're behind a driver we don't like, where like you just like start going by and you just casually turn your head because you're like, who are you? I just need to know who you are. There's no one in the seat. And I was like, why have this on the road? I don't want to deal with this stuff. And that's like that's my same feeling about VR headsets. Like I do not want something that's going to be strapped to my face for hours. I'm going to be sweating. I don't even sweat that much. I'm still going to be sweating. It's going to get gross and damp. And then I'm just going to have literally like a screen the whole time. Like I can't stare off into the distance and try to think about whatever problem I'm having with a spreadsheet or a piece of phrasing in a story I'm working on. Like these aren't, I think you even said it yesterday, Kreider, you're like, this is an answer to a problem nobody, like a solution for a problem that nobody has. That's what it feels like to me. And I hate to crap on something that is the stuff of science fiction, but it's like, when's it gonna work? That's my question. When's it gonna work? I'm done now.
Well, I
have feelings apparently. I guess I'm not as moderated about this as I thought.
Yeah, right. I was about to say, I was like, it's not a very middling take.
No, it actually sounds like you would agree with me that no. Well, yeah. My feeling is you can dream all you want. Just dream with somebody else's money because it ain't going to be mine.
Well, no one's forcing you to buy this. Yeah. And like I said, almost no one is going to buy a $3,500 headset. But I think if Apple is not infallible, but also is not stupid, if they didn't see a very clear, very mass market future for this technology, they wouldn't be building the platform that they're building.
Yeah, this feels very un-Apple-like, where usually Apple is very late to the game, right? Usually they mm-hmm. take their time to jump into something, and then they're like, oh, okay, we're here first, you know, because we did it the best. This feels very early, where it's like, wait, this is still like very early tech. Why are you guys jumping in right now? I'm not quite sure.
I mean, feels like a Newton instead of an iPhone. Is what?
Yeah, yeah. Because I mean, the iPhone, like, I mean, they weren't the first to come to the, you know, the smartphone thing, of course, but they were one of the best ones to do it. And they, you know, and obviously, I mean, the price at the beginning was higher. But I mean, the idea was, I mean, kind of the same thing with the iPod, right? They weren't the first ones to portable music players, but when they did get in it, they had a good product. This one feels different. This one doesn't feel like, oh man, everyone's doing it. When is Apple going to do it? I can't wait. You know, this is more like, oh, Apple's getting into this? Huh. Okay. Well, huh. That means they think maybe this is a thing. I don't know. But I think there's also, we're talking about a couple different problems here, right? Mm-hmm. You inherently have people who are not comfortable using this kind of stuff, no matter what implementation it is. like Elena, I don't want to speak for her because she stepped out, but you know, I know there are some people who just aren't comfortable wearing it, who will get motion sick. So no matter what iteration it is, it doesn't matter. They just like my wife's the same way. Like I've tried to have her put on some of the best headsets out there, and she's just like, I can't do it. You know? So I think there's an inherent nature of just using the thing, right? There's the cost, which no matter what iteration you have right now, the cost is still, you know, like it's still a niche kind of thing. I'd say the closest thing was maybe when you could take your Samsung phone and strap it in a piece of plastic, so the cost was pretty low there because you already had the phone, mm-hmm. but it just wasn't a good experience.
Google did one made out of cardboard that was practically free.
Same thing,
not,
right?
Not really a comparable experience.
Yeah. But, you know, yeah. So, I mean, we like to say that this around here, that there's no such thing as a bad product, but a bad price, right? Like if this headset came out and it was $50, oh crap, you know, a lot of people are going to buy this, right? But then it at the end of the day, it comes down to content. Like to Gordon's point, man, do I ever see myself editing a video in something like this? Like I could try that now with the headsets I have, but I don't know why I would. Like what do I get out of that I don't get just sitting at a computer like this? So, you know, I think there's that. So then inherently how I use it, because I do use my Quest still often, and it's for games, right? So, you mm-hmm. know, if there's like interesting gaming experiences, but that's the other thing is that there's not a ton of interesting gaming experiences that I'm like, oh man, I can't wait to play this new game that came out. So it's like all these problems. Like I actually think the tech is the least problem right now. Because I think the processing is nice, the actual screens themselves are nice, like the comfort can be there for sure. So I actually think the tech is pretty far along compared to the other things of like getting people comfortable even just wearing it, the kind of content you want to do in it, and then the content that is interesting, just there's not enough of it. So
it is a very strange launch, because it feels like if you were to use your Newton analogy. For people who don't know, and I actually have a Newton somewhere here. A Newton was basically an early PDA. It was pen-based. It was quite amazing for its time. Groundbreaking technology. Went nowhere, as did all pen-based technology. Pen-based technology died years and years ago because, frankly, there's no way you could ever understand everybody's handwriting. And it just went nowhere. To me, this is like... And with the state of VR today and AR, it's like introducing the Newton after it was clear that all pen-based PDAs had died. Like, it's almost like, well, hell, we spent $1 billion on this. Let's just introduce it anyway and see if it sticks.
Yeah, but I understand why you think VR is dead, but it is not dead. It is still around. Like, I mean, there's definitely, like, sure, they're not making hand over fist money on it. But, I mean, it's kind of like... analog photography, right? There's still an industry of people who like to still shoot on film. I'm sorry, Gordon, like there is, like Polaroid film. Like, I mean, if you look at some of the best sold cameras on Amazon right now, it's those little Fuji Instax. You know what I mean? So like, I know you're shaking your head, but like they make a lot of money by selling.
Statistically,
I know, but that's the difference between you saying film is dead versus, oh no, it's still there. There's just a nice little industry. It doesn't need to be the hugest thing in the world, because same thing with VR. It's not dead. There's a little industry there, and it's not, you know, the huge thing at the end of the world, but it's still there. It's not dead. So, you know, that's the other thing is that like,
there's still people who record audio on those early waxed impression things. I'm sure, Adam, right? Are there? Yes. I'm sure there's one person, maybe 12, who record on early wax impressions
going
for
to the
those
extremes.
That's a no, but that one. is true.
If your going definition to the is,
if your definition of any microbial life is life,
no,
I'm
that's not my definition.
So sure that's...
I'm saying that you're making it sound like VR needs to be the biggest thing ever to actually matter, but no, it doesn't. It's a small part of life, and it doesn't need to be the next hugest thing that we're all gonna buy and just all gonna love. Like, it's just a small thing. Like, that's why, like, the Apple thing feels weird, because usually they get into things that are probably going to be a huge part of our life, right? Before the smartphone, did we think our phones were going to literally take over our lives like this? No, but, you know, like the Apple probably didn't either. They got into it pretty late, and now they're one of the biggest smartphone manufacturers out there. You know, and if same thing, you think about the watch or the HomePod, like, hey, everybody needs some sort of audio device, well, right?
But I would say that the direction that smartphones is going in, when Apple got into it and everybody was making smartphones on Windows CE and Palm OS, was like this. Would you say VR is going like this, Adam? Like this? Or like this? And I would say definitely VR feels like it's going this way.
I know you're saying it feels like, but that's the root of the thing. You're saying it feels like, but not everyone else is saying that. So I did a poll,
and it's
about 50-50. It's about 50-50. So between our little, you know, segment of people who are listening here, they're about 50-50 on is VR dead. So, you know,
I don't think VR is dead. I don't think it's dead at all. I think
how do you define life?
Well, if you're on life support, you are still alive.
Yes, you are still alive. There's no activity we're detecting. There's quality of life issues, but no. Let's keep it going.
That you could make a case that there are quality of life issues that have not been addressed yet, still for VR.
And the bill. You want the bill for?
Yeah. I would say, though, that it's also fair to say that, you know, what almost 10 years ago, at least, like, was like, I feel like around 2014, 2015 is when we were seeing like that huge, like, oh my God, VR, right? So there's this huge spike of interest. Everybody was chasing it. And then there was like kind of a big drop, right? But no, people didn't stop, Gordon. It just kind of like settled much, much, much lower than where the hype had brought it up to.
I'm going to look up 3D television. Oh, yeah. You know, you can actually still get 3D televisions. Did you know that?
I feel like you're about to tell us.
Yeah, you can still buy 3D televisions.
Wait, are you crapping on 3D televisions?
Yes, because nobody buys 3D televisions. Wait,
hold on. We did a video at GDC where you saw a 3D monitor and you thought it was
glass,
the best thing since sliced bread.
With glasses and
3D TVs with glasses.
I will say,
okay.
If you can do 3D television for multiple people, glassless, with that same experience, it's pretty damn good.
Okay, wait. So then, it sounds like you need an asterisk on the VR. So VR isn't dead.
Is that asterisk. VR?
No. I'm saying you just put the caveat on it. You were like, oh. Because initially you were like, oh yeah, 3D TVs are dead. And then you were like, glasses 3D TVs. So.
I really love that Asus has it. Acer has it. It's glasses VR. It's incredible. Do I think I want to give my money for it or for you to put your money in? Do I think it's going to be here in 5 years? I'm going to put my money on that. I'm going to bet probably not. I wish it would. It's cool technology. And we know where that goes. Generally.
You're pretty excited about it. I'm excited about it. We didn't do
a video
at CES.
VR. I have a Valve Index. We got on the waiting list for the Valve Index. But again, realistically, I can tell you, man, I don't know. It just feels like, you know, 6 months ago, I would have said, no, it wasn't dead. But honestly, I mean, it ain't got much life is what I'm saying. It's not dead, maybe. Maybe not totally dead, but it ain't got much life. It just feels like everything's just flopping. And I'm just thinking about all of these VR headsets I've used, and like there's that Lenovo one, like a lot of really cool things, and they all flop, right? Google spent hundreds of millions of dollars on this with their partners. Microsoft has spent hundreds of millions of dollars with its partners. Ask any of those companies where they would like their hundreds of millions of dollars back.
Gordon, real quick. You've said this before on the podcast, and you've said it to me personally. When we look at sales of NVIDIA GPUs, right. You know, and there's anecdotal evidence of like, oh man, there's a ton on the shelf. You know, there's a lot of people out there who say it's a flop, and usually tell me or tell the audience, do we have hard numbers? We need to look for the evidence. So I would say the same thing to you, Gordon. I know you say it feels like VR is flop, but I haven't seen any hard numbers of a company coming out and saying, hey, you know what, we lost money on this. Or what? So I would say, you know, let's
well, let's wait for numbers. I could definitely argue headline saying that everybody's saying that Facebook's $1 billion investment is going nowhere, right? We know they've canned people on that project. They did. I mean,
their headline saying
anyway.
there was a lot of 4080s on the shelves. These things aren't selling, Gordon.
Yeah, but so
I saw those headlines.
When I mean headlines, I mean authoritative headlines. Not a headline written on
there's
somebody else's headline based on one store from one country.
No. Everybody's seeing 4080s on the shelf and 4060 Ti's on the shelf. Like that's not just sales figures.
What I'm saying is you have to have there's definitely a lot of headlines that would indicate the momentum for VR has stalled, right? Right now it's stalled. The plane is stalled in midair and it is going nowhere. I mean, I just don't
know.
And
there's a lot of headlines saying that 40 series is not selling, but usually tell me, hey, you know what? We don't have the answer.
Yeah. And you know what? And what I'm saying is you reserve judgment. And I talk to people, believe me, those headlines, I have a lot of evidence to say that it's correct based on information that I cannot talk about. But when those headlines pushed on somebody talking about somebody, that is not good enough for me to go by. Evidence for me talking to vendors and saying, yeah, there's definitely some of these things are not selling. That's different. What I'm saying is headlines in the Wall Street Journal from reputable places saying like, this is dead. They've killed this. This is canceled. This is $500 billion down the drain or $500 million down the drain. I take that as evidence that AR and VR is flopping, and I'm really pessimistic on it right now. I mean, I just don't honestly see it digging itself out of this hole.
I would just like to interject very quickly that towards the beginning of the show, Gordon was referring to YouTube and Reddit as headlines as well. So I am just confused now what a headline is, Gordon.
What? Because what is being said. So the headlines that are being talked about, right? The way to in the modern world to consume modern media today, you have to consider the source on everything. Think about it. Think about what's being said. Weigh each of those. And then think, is this realistic? Does this match other data? And yes, you know what? People like to crap on everybody who talks on Reddit, but you may actually find the most authoritative post on Reddit that you will find anywhere else, because those are some of the real experts that are on spending their time in some of those subreddits to post on things. So people just want to crap on Reddit as general. I think that is unfair. But the crap on the usual, I'm just repeating what I saw and that kind of, yes, that is definitely low information posts. Yeah, that is definitely unworthy. But there are some Reddit posts that are on there. There are some YouTube comments from people that know their shit. And I think those are that you can't dismiss. You have to look at it, and sometimes, is this a crank? Is this real? I mean, you have to evaluate every single source of information now. You just simply can't consider it. But when a company, public company comes out and we just flush this entire project down the toilet, that's real.
Which one flushed down the toilet? Because Meta just announced a brand new
They just canned a bunch of people on the project. We know some of them.
Well, I mean, think but everybody's
HoloLens,
laying people off.
HoloLens,
that's not necessarily.
Microsoft killed HoloLens, HP, Lenovo, Dell. A whole bunch of OEMs got dragged into mixed reality headsets. Mm-hmm. Toilet, right? I mean, what? I mean, that's real numbers, right? So what exactly?
I mean, you could have said the same thing about tablet PCs 20 years ago, and now half the stuff that's sold is a tablet.
Oh, Mike. Oh, Mike, you should probably pop out now.
What's a tablet PC, Mike? What is a tablet PC?
I remember Microsoft's tablet PC.
And let me tell you, Apple iPad and Samsung and some $25 Amazon Fire tablet, where are the tablet players now?
Where are the tablet players aside from these hundreds of millions that are sold?
Yes, but where are all of their players? Where is this?
OnePlus did just announce a new tablet, surprisingly.
If you ignore the biggest parts of the market doesn't matter.
Yeah. No, but I mean, do you remember what the predictions were in 2012?
That's a good idea. We should leave.
What was it? We were all going to give up our laptops and desktops for our tablets. Everybody sitting out in the grass doing work, right? That was a prediction?
Mm-hmm. Your Honor, may I make my closing statement?
The reality did not match. That's what was we're told we were going to get.
All right.
And that's what we were told. PC was dead.
And VR, I think, has amazing potential specifically for entertainment and, frankly, not much beyond that. You've got some professional applications in training. Like my mother is a doctorate of nursing down in Texas, and they have replaced, or they're looking to replace, like an $80,000 medical training dummy with some of these Oculus VR systems that they're looking into right now. That's a really cool application that's incredibly niche. And on top of that, you've got entertainment. You've got games and movies. And some people think it's really cool. Some people will never do it. Some people right now have never played video games in their life, even people who are younger than you would think. AR, I think, has a lot more capability to transform the way we use technology in and around, specifically in a mobile way. And I'll point out, three of the four people on this podcast are wearing glasses. And I know three of the four people on this podcast, at least, have used smartwatches. And 20 years ago, the idea of sticking a computer that can run apps in your watch was ridiculous until you can start to find ways that it becomes useful. Is it useful yet? No. Will it become useful within 5 years, within 10 years? I think it certainly will. I think Apple is waiting for that. And building a foundation for that. Whether they're making the right bet at the right time, that goes back to whether this is the Newton or the iPhone. And for that, we're just going to have to wait and see.
So where would you put your money then on this? Put your bet down.
Here we go.
I wouldn't put all my money on it. But if I had some to blow, and not that I do, because I don't invest in technology because I'm a technology journalist, I would put a little money on Apple doing this just because they have the capability and apparently they have the will to make it happen.
Well, I don't mean investing in stocks. I mean, like, you know, in Vegas, they will bet on everything. Is that fly going to land on that stick? Mm-hmm. Okay, let's see. They'll put odds on that. What's your odds for whatever this vision thing is continuing? 5 years, I can't imagine them blowing this up in 5 years. Do you think this vision, or whatever AR, VR goggle will still exist in 10 years?
In 10 years, yes.
You're going to put your money down. You're going to put your
will still exist? 100%.
Will be much more common and ubiquitous, I would say, for AR, absolutely. That's my bet. For VR, I think it could go either way. You could get a lot of people into... I think we're in, like, the silent movie era of VR entertainment, where people are still experimenting in a lot of ways and don't know how to make it work. Like, if you go back in the history of film and you look at the silent film era, they were doing absolutely insane things with camera techniques, with practical effects, things that would still blow your mind today because it's a brand new medium and they're still discovering how all this will work, how it can work. That's where VR is at right now, both in terms of entertainment and in terms of simulation, where even the lines are blurring. That, frankly, doesn't interest me as much as augmented reality. Whether you call augmented reality looking through a camera or looking at the real world with stuff projected around it, that has incredible potential to me on the same level of smartphones, smartwatches. So yes, in 10 years, I see that becoming very possibly ubiquitous, and I would put money on that.
Okay. I'm certain we will have colonies on Mars one day. And we will leave our solar system, but I will not be on this planet probably by then. So I just don't think it's, well, I'm so pessimistic now because just the graveyard of failures here is tremendous.
Okay, that's harsh, Gordon. That's harsh. I mean,
the graveyard of failed VR AR projects.
The thing is that you are expecting, I mean, in fairness, you are expecting a timeline of, inception to daily usage, like practical daily usage on a much shortened timeline compared to a lot of the other technologies we've seen. I mean, computers, when they first got started, like it was like decades before they got even small enough to be in our homes. like the whole thing with smartphones, it took a while before they were able to nail down a ubiquitous, wide reach application of it. And also, I wanted to address this, you know, in terms of the whole headset thing for AR, VR with Apple. I think the reason why I'm just not sold on this, Adam, is because Apple of today, let's say post, you know, them almost biting it and having the basically the iPod save them from, you know, insolvency, they don't do things unless they're so confident that everyone's going to go, yes, I see absolutely why I would need one, or why a competitor is going to come out with the thing that I want because this one's too locked down, right? They did that with the iPhone. So yeah, there were other precursors to the iPhone, but PDAs were kind of a thing that people did either to say how important they were, or because they just liked having that kind of like cool technology in their hands, right? But when the iPhone came out, a lot of people were like, oh, wait, I see the utility in that. People who were not technology oriented even, right? They're like, yes, that is a much better way to be able to check my like email. This is a much better way for me to have instant communication with people through text message. They got it. They understood it. Even the Apple Watch, not as wide utility or application, but people who were like, yes, I have so many notifications. I need a way to be able to get like see them and not have to like interact. Oh, hi, Kitty. Interact with them. Right? This headset, they did not present it, at least to me, in a way that made me go, yes, everyone's going to want to have one because they see how it's going to be able to improve their lives. Like, this is the best way to do some virtual trainings. This is the best way to hold meetings. This is the best way to do this. Like, there's nothing universal enough about it that would make people go, ah. So to me, it's weird. Like, it feels too early. It's like they got so excited about it that they released it before they hit that, like, that set point where they're like, okay, yeah, everyone's going to want one now. Like, we can charge whatever we want for it.
Yeah.
So to that point, I would like to say it's like lunchtime out here.
Yeah.
The cat's prowling because he still wants more food. I would like food at some point. We have another topic to go and yeah. Question and answer. So I feel like as much as I love you both, maybe we should let this one kind of sit as a stalemate between Gordon and Kreider.
I rest my case, Your Honor.
luckily for either, like the answer for this is like 10 plus years out. So it's not like we're going to be able to come back next year and be like, ah, see, I told you so. So, but good point. Yes, we should switch to the next topic, which is fall CPU launches. So this one's kind of a multi-parter. First off, we put up a video with Wendell from Level One Techs. Always good to chat with him over on our YouTube channel, or I guess that's where you're watching this now. So you should go watch it. It was interesting because both Gordon and Wendell saw Z790 motherboard refreshes at Computex, which hinted towards what the potential Intel CPUs are going to be in the fall. So there's that side. And then AMD... got out and talked about their AM5 roadmap, which wasn't pure consumer. They didn't come out and, you know, say anything specific about consumer stuff, but I think there's at least a little bit to kind of gleam into this. So Gordon, please tell us what can people expect from CPUs in the fall?
Well, you know, one of them is this fall. The other one is not really this fall, unfortunately, but we kind of counted there because the news comes there. Public confirmation, of course, is AMD. They basically showed off their AMD socket roadmap. I dropped that graphic in there, Adam, if you want to show it or not. But
yep,
basically showing that, hey, we got AM5. We established that with 2023 with Zen 4 with Navi 3.0, which some people are saying, wait a minute, I thought that wasn't Navi 3.0. But they're now confirming, which is not much of a shocker, but they are confirming that Ryzen 8000 will come, you know, Zen 5, and that will come with Navi's 3.5, and that's going to come in 2024. So not exactly a surprise. You will get another generation of AMD Ryzen processors in the AM5 socket, and that'll come in 2024. So not really a big shocker, but it is nice to see them at least publicly confirm it. Kind of just move the ball down the field a little bit. For Intel, there's a lot more speculation because we know there's a refresh supposedly coming second half of this year. The rumors are that it would be a Raptor Lake refresh. Some people still think Meteor Lake will come. There's some people who think Meteor Lake will be on desktop, has been sort of, is not going to come. It'll only be a laptop part. Some people consider that canceled. I don't know if that's canceled or not. So there's also a possibility that when we see the 14th gen CPU, it might be Raptor Lake refresh instead of actually Meteor Lake cores when it comes. So that is a distinct possibility. I also want to point out Gigabyte and MSI apparently dropped BIOS updates that show supports. The update supports, this came out May 31st for the Z790 Aorus Extreme board. The F4D BIOS supports and powers up Intel and supports and powers up Intel next generation processor. So clearly a 14th gen CPU probably that will come in the socket. Wendell and I were discussing whether this should be called 13th gen or 14th gen, because if it's Meteor Lake 14th gen, if it's basically a clock boosted Raptor Lake refresh, is that really 14th gen or is that 13th gen? Who knows what's going to happen? Although I do like, you know, Wendell getting everybody very excited for the idea that maybe it will actually be a Raptor Lake refresh, but they give people what they sort of wanted, which was an all P core version. So 10 P cores in the same socket. And the one thing that he saw at Computex were a lot of motherboards. They were Z790 chipsets that work with existing Intel CPUs, but with really, really beefed up power. So beefed up power clearly implies this next generation of CPU for Intel is going to want even more power, which seems kind of crazy. But that would kind of go with the idea of a Raptor Lake part that hits higher clocks. And also it kind of goes with the idea of like, hey, maybe they pull out the E cores and then they put in two more P cores in order to give you, you know, to fit within that thermal and power envelope. So again, it could be everywhere from what we're getting from existing Raptor Lake CPUs with just higher clock boosts, which I actually, that's what I expect, because I sort of think that's what usually happens at the sort of the end of the socket. It gives PC vendors something to sell, something newer. So I sort of expect basically same core count, same thread count, you know, more clock speed. Maybe there's some thought that maybe there's a feature that didn't make it into the original Raptor Lake that will now be enabled that will let them push higher clocks at more power, but not a crazy amount more power. So maybe they can, maybe that'll be kind of part of the excitement for a potentially 14th gen part. But I think that's pretty much the lay of the land as we're seeing it out of the Computex news, as well as this BIOS update. So not a lot of news there, although honestly I could get excited for a 10 core P core that is clocked up over, you know, current parts.
If it were the 10 P core, I'm sorry, were you saying it would have any E core, or it would just be a scaled back E core?
Well, I mean, it sounds like Wendell was sort of suggesting they lose the E cores, right? Because, you know, they could give you it all if they had, you know, a workstation size socket in there, which increases cost. It's just not reasonable for consumers, even at the prices we're paying for them for a workstation board. So the idea is you lose the E cores and you get nothing but the P cores, right? So maybe we sort of get a mini Sapphire Rapids kind of thing, potentially, which I like that idea, because having more P cores would be pretty nice. Although at the same time, the E cores were actually pretty nifty too, so that's a bummer. But if, you know, obviously they would tune the, you know, any 10 core P core part to be obviously faster than the existing CPU. So that would be part of the math they have to do there.
I mean, but would a 10 P core part beat the current 13900KS in Cinebench?
It might get close. Multi-threaded? It might be closer than we expect, but again, maybe that's why they push the power up. Because then they have to push the clocks up, push the TDP up to get more performance. It maybe doesn't have to crush it in multi-core performance, but it has to be faster because people won't settle for less. But it's, but the you may actually just get potential upsides everywhere too, right? So because 10 P cores is, and the math may work out, but you know, that might have just been Wendell messing with us, but I like that idea, you know, because if you take all that power and you really push those P cores really hard, you can, you know, Intel is Raptor Lake was no joke, right? That was a fast CPU. So if it's potentially faster, more power hungry, people may accept that.
What if they go the other way? Dr. Ian Cutress is happy they got 2 P cores and 32 E cores.
He wants all the E cores. Yeah, he'd be happy for that. I don't think that's something consumers want, though.
Yeah, no, I'm just kidding.
It just doesn't work. Like, you know, because the interesting is like, well, maybe the single threaded performance is bumped up too, right? So they, besides the fact that you're doing 10 P cores, maybe the clock speeds for the lightly threaded stuff is significant increase, and then that, and of course, in the all important fastest gaming CPU category, then that would give them their checkoff, and they could claim that, right? And that's actually worth it, right? Because the only thing they really have to beat is not Raptor Lake 13th gen. The only thing they really have to beat is X3D parts.
The other question I have is something we talked about before. It was funny, last year we recorded a video saying, hey, is 13th gen the last CPU generation in this socket? And all the comments were like, oh yeah, this is it. You know, you're done. There's no more. But now it's almost kind of looking like there's going to be three generations. There's going to be a 14th gen, whatever it is. It looks like there's going to be 14th gen in the same socket. I mean, and that's kind of a big deal. Even if it's just a simple Raptor Lake refresh, like that's still something Intel hasn't done in a while, right? Is to have three generations in one socket.
Boy, I'm trying to think if technically would a KS part count there, like a 9th gen KS. Because you had some 8700Ks overlap with 9000 parts, right? I'm trying to think. I can't remember back that far already.
I wonder if the branding we've heard about, or the rebranding that's coming up probably before the end of the year that we keep hearing about, where they're going to drop the I on all of the core i3, i5, i7. I wonder if that's equating into this anywhere, making their decisions on whether to jump to a new socket or not. Seems like a done deal at this point.
I don't think it'll show up here. I think we were going to see this weird split where we see Meteor Lake, because you know Brad and I were talking about it, and it makes a lot of sense to do the Ultra stuff with the next generation GPU cores that are going to be significantly better. So then you have a way to differentiate the different, you know, VPU cores, the different GPU cores. So you have that Ultra nomenclature to sort of break out those differences. But if that is only in a laptop part, it's potential we could see Core i7, 10, whatever, Ultra on laptops. And then 14th gen, right? And then, no, actually, I, the numbers they're throwing around are 1,000. And then on the desktop part, it's potential we could see, you know, still, you know, 14th gen Core i9, 14900K. Right, that's entirely possible too. So, I could see them doing that weird naming, because Intel's done it before. They've done crazy things like on mobile when they had Ice Lake parts, and they had Comet Lake. So they had like 5-letter Core i7-10700U, and then they had like Core i7-10-1050U or something like that. It was like what, 4-digit and 5-digit and U parts in the exact same timeline. So it was strange when they were forced to do it because of the parts they had to sell. So yeah. Ultra may not even show up on the desktop part.
Yeah, I mean it's weird all around, right? I mean, because then the other potential scenario is we have like the stack, the highest end stack is a refresh of Raptor Lake, mid down the stack on desktop I'm talking about is Raptor Lake. And then maybe the real low end stuff is still Alder Lake, all within 14th gen, right?
Yeah, I mean we've seen it before, right? It's that reality of where they got to have different things to sell to different markets, and for AMD too, right? That's what we had. That's why we had that wheel of different cores for their mobile parts, because they clearly expected to sell older mobile parts alongside newer mobile parts.
Yeah.
Makes our jobs harder as people who are supposed to be helping others make sound technology decisions, right? Where somebody comes to you and they say, well, I heard so much about this high-end stuff, or like, when are they going to launch the like the more affordable ones? And you're like, well, well.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. So not, I mean, there isn't a lot of information to really bite on, but it's interesting. We probably will see another generation of CPUs in the same socket. So I'm with you, Adam, depending on what
which
it
is. Which is big news. I mean, I even if it's not great, that's still big news to say, hey, three generations in one socket.
It's definitely better for Intel, right?
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
I don't know. I feel like we're all a little low energy right now because three of us at least are hungry, probably. I don't know what your snacking schedule is like, Kreider, if you actually have one. But I would say that with Brad not here, like, I want to talk a little bit about speculation and things I'd like to see because, you know, he's not always so hot on us.
Do it, please.
And all of that.
Well, what would you like to see?
But I mean, I get where Gordon's coming from with the whole, like, you know, seeing just pure performance cores in a single chip as exciting. But honestly, I'm more looking forward to seeing what kind of APUs that might come down the pipeline. I really, really want to see some refresh APUs. And I want to see if Intel is going to give us something equivalent to what we've seen so far from AMD for our APUs, right? Like now that they have Arc and now, I mean, they've got obviously their CPU lineup, like let's have like a little like sandwich of Intel, all Intel goodness and see how that performs. Like, I think that'd be pretty cool. I want to see stuff like that, right? I mean, don't get me wrong. We obviously love performance here, but I also think innovation and like new products and things that address people's needs in different ways is really cool too. Like one of the things I've been working on behind the scenes here is looking at power consumption for like different gaming rigs and different setups I've got. I've been talking to some people from different regions about their energy costs, and it is really wild like how much some people are paying right now versus other areas. And so this stuff kind of matters in, like, it doesn't sound like much, right? Where you're like, oh, I paid an extra 30 cents today, but that adds up. Like, it adds up pretty quickly. So I would love to see more options that are more power efficient or allow you to have power efficiency, right? So maybe you don't need a discrete graphics card to play whatever game you're playing. Because as much as I know you love American muscle car type chips, Gordon, not everyone can afford the fuel economy on them.
Well, I'm thankful we have a plentiful fuel here. But why not go with a laptop at that point?
Because sometimes you want to be able to customize it the way you want to.
Well, I mean, I'm just, if you're looking for performance per watt, it's really hard to beat a gaming laptop because you can do 1440p gaming at high refresh rates under 300 watts. So,
yeah, but cost is a factor too.
Yeah, cost is a factor. But I mean, if it's, you know, it seems like at that point, you kind of really do need to look at mobile gaming because it's everything.
Yes, right? We're just going to go the extreme opposite end. No more PC gaming, no console gaming.
No, not mobile gaming, because mobile gaming to me is laptop gaming, right? So,
that's not how we use the phrase, Gordon.
Yeah,
but that's because I don't consider mobile gaming to be mobile gaming the way people traditionally do. So like Angry Birds, I don't consider that to be gaming in a lot of ways because I'm just kind of wired that way. But honestly, gaming laptops really do offer the best bang for the buck with efficiency. And I don't know how that you could ever beat that with desktop, you know?
I mean,
But again, you that's leaving out a very key part of the equation, which is the money factor, how much your budget is and what you can get for the same amount of money. And if you already have a setup that has a monitor and all that, like, do you really need a laptop if you're not traveling with it, et cetera, et cetera? It always boils down to like what's your use case, right? So
yeah,
it's definitely tighter though, because I mean, discrete is always gonna easily beat APUs even in their next generation from these companies. So
those in a desktop computer.
I'm sorry.
I said you can always upgrade those in a desktop computer.
The APU.
True. Yeah.
No, I mean, yeah, but I just kind of like, I don't know. I do think people are that really are so against laptops, if you really are living in a very power-restricted mode, then you really should think about a laptop, to be honest.
Well, yeah, speaking of APUs, a lot of people, I see a lot of chatter, not only in our Slack here, but even in Discord, just talking about when are we going to get new Ryzen APUs, right? I mean, it's been a bit.
Yep.
Yeah, who knows what's going to be the timetable for that.
Instead of Vega.
Yeah, that would be exciting. It would definitely be exciting. I kind of wonder, the question is, do they do an AM4 or AM5, right? So probably AM5 at this point.
Yeah. We'd have to see.
Yeah. Okay. I think let's move over to Q&A. Does that sound good? Do a couple quick ones, and then we will go to lunch. We had a question, a good question over on our Discord from friend of the show, Master Procrastinator. This kind of goes back to Computex. What was your favorite PC case that you saw at Computex?
Ooh boy,
If you had to pick one.
What's that? I have to pick just one. You're talking to somebody who has 5 PCs on your desk right now.
Blame Master Procrastinator.
I really like that the Leon Lee, the PCMR one that they introduced.
11D Vision.
Yeah, it really is really pretty. It is kind of a wide case for me. So I really do like it. Just for all the that all glass look is pretty pretty.
It's pretty.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with the Fractal Design Terra.
Yeah, that was mine.
I mean, in addition to the cool colors that they're using, which a couple of other vendors were going on that multicolor sort of very pastel look. I mean, it's just such a clean layout. And like I said before the show, I don't know if we were recording. I like my PCs to look like tiny little refrigerators, and this is a beautiful refrigerator. So.
Liquid, a friend of the show, Liquid RS, Gordon on that Asus board that we saw with the reverse connectors, are they using an existing standard that could easily be adopted by other manufacturers, or was that proprietary to Asus?
For the connector, for the GPU slot, yeah, for the power connector, I believe it was borrowed from, they said from Enterprise. They must make a product for some server or Enterprise product, because I was wondering if it was just a grounds up, but they said they borrowed it from data center, so it probably is an existing connector, because you generally makes it really expensive to have, you know, Amp or Molex make a custom connector for you. You just kind of pick something off the shelf that handles the power they need. So that's my guess.
Okay. Let's see. A friend of the show, CosMC, asks, given the AI and server focus of Computex this year, Windows 365, cloud PC, and virtualization are no longer hiding in the pro/workstation component in both GPU and CPU spaces. Is the future of the home PC in home labbing and thin client? Imagine you have one computer in your house and then you have 5 users connecting to it.
That's hard to see. I mean, definitely some models are pushing for that. I don't see it drastically changing immediately. Yeah, the question, though, is there enough power to do it on your desktop, laptop client for all the expected AI loads? Or do you have to run everything on the cloud? I don't know. But I kind of think people who just like to do it locally will pay off. But we'll have to see, right? We'll have to see when we get there. That's my guess. I don't know if anybody else has any input on it.
I like the idea, but yeah. Then once again, you're having to be you're probably the one in the household. If it's a big household, that would have to manage it. And
yeah, I can't see anybody wanting to do that. And if they wanted to, why wouldn't they just go full cloud for that?
Yeah, and then you know the classic Right now, you have one computer that breaks out of five. You have four computers that are still up and running. When that thing breaks, it all breaks. So yeah. I don't know if that's a model people are ready for.
If it goes full cloud, too, like that also, you know, supposes or assumes that you have reliable internet. And there are definitely places in the world, including the United States, where that is not a guarantee or a given.
Yeah. Although in some ways we're already living in the cloud, we just don't know it. So.
Okay. Come more real quick and we'll wrap up. Oh, that's not a question. Never mind. It was a hot take from CosMC. I guess I'll read it. can we cut the BS for a minute and be real that NVIDIA has never been for gamers? Gaming GPUs were and will always be a byproduct of server and workstation GPUs. 2020 through 2022 showed NVIDIA didn't care about gamers. Compared to the usage of what companies are willing to pay for GPUs, gaming is a niche market for NVIDIA.
I'm not sure. So 2022, well, were we saying that?
Reference to the miners.
Yeah, right? Yeah. From 2020 to 2022, most of their GPUs were sold to.
Yeah, I mean, but that's.
I think that was a pretty big anomaly in market terms.
Yeah, I think the thing is, like, the question is, are the cards developed for gamers at all? Is the question we're talking about, not whether the company's business practices in unusual times.
Well, no, he's saying gaming GPUs were and will always be a byproduct of server and workstation GPUs, which we do talk about that on the Arc side, right? That's one of the arguments of like, hey, you know what? Arc is still going to be around because they want to get into the server space. So Arc will, you know, if you're going to be in the server space, you might as well make a gaming version too. So.
Yeah, but the argument there is they've split the units off because now the graphics, there's firmly a graphics for consumers and there's firmly, you know, graphics for data center. So I don't know if that theory holds anymore. For NVIDIA, yeah, no, definitely they try to build something that appeals to both because it's really expensive to build separate things. The question is whether that served gamers or not. You know, obviously the NVIDIA answer is like, look, this is giving you DLSS3. This is giving you frame generation. This is giving you all these other things that basically have benefited gamers directly. And this is because of our investment in what has also, of course, served us really nice to sell hardware into data centers. So they're clearly trying to do synergy. They're not trying to build an all-out gaming card. And then, hey, let's do some data center thing later or do it after. And so there's definitely crossover. But then we're really getting into the question of like, has that benefited you? I don't know. You know, I would know what NVIDIA would say. And like, we are kicking the hell out of everybody with our 4090 card. So we think we are doing it. And that does trickle down to some of the lower end parts. So that's what they would say. But, you know, I don't know if you can flat out say you're right and they can flat out say they're right. So what it'll come down to is in the next generation and generation after that, if they are not giving you more value for you as a gamer than the competition is, then yeah, they've definitely lost. And then you should obviously buy somebody else's products. That's the way it should be. But I don't really think I subscribe to your that they don't care. So I'm not sure I believe in that.
Okay. Last question before we get out of here. A friend of the show, VC Jester, asks, how much does it annoy you when people talk like gaming is the only thing a computer is used for?
Well, it annoys me a lot because it is a little nutty because the crazy thing is if they just simply say it's the only thing I use it for, that's perfectly fine. The problem is a lot of people who only want to push the gaming first narrative want to exclude all other uses of the, you know, billions of personal computers out there, which is kind of silly, I think. So yes, it does annoy the hell out of me. Anybody else?
I don't think it annoys me. And I would say that I feel like for people who regard a computer as a tool right? Like if you are somebody who crunches tons of data in Excel, if you are somebody who is doing content creation, like a video editor for like a major studio or, you know, whatever freelance thing you're doing, right? It's just a tool to you, right? You don't necessarily have your skin in the game. You're not on a team per se. You just want to know what does the best job for what you're going to do. And it doesn't really matter to you what has the, what's in the zeitgeist, right? I think the most that would probably annoy you is that if there's never any news about the things that you care about, right? I think that would be the most annoying part. But the fact that so many gamers are so passionate and they want so much attention and that they invest themselves into this as a thing, then like, I don't think it really affects you. So I think for me, it doesn't bother me so much because I mean, let them have their fun, you know, let them talk to the companies, push, and you know what? If that means that I also get games that I want to play, great. Be vocal.
But it doesn't annoy you when they basically insist nothing else exists except for their thing. That doesn't annoy you? That doesn't seem completely myopic, self-centered, like this entire universe circles around the earth kind of?
Doing that though. I think that they're just very tunnel visioned, but I think that's different than actively refuting the fact that other applications exist.
Oh my God, what do I need all these cores for? I only want good gaming.
If that's what you care about, then buy a console, buy a device that does gaming more than anything else.
I was looking for a reaction. I'm not
gonna. if somebody told me that, I mean, the idea that PCs are or even can be only for gaming and nothing else, that doesn't annoy me because that proposition is so ridiculous, I would just ignore it. It's like that one Mad Men scene where you got the guy pouring out his heart in the elevator and the other guy's like, I don't think about you at all. Show me somebody who only games on a PC and never looks at Wikipedia, never pays their power bill on the browser, and I'll be very impressed that that person exists.
Well, that's the problem though, Mike, is there, that is actually a feeling of a lot of people out there. And we do that every time there's a launch. And if the product simply doesn't appeal, is sort of tailored for their market. Classic is 7950X 3D or 7950X and the lower core count parts. Like suddenly, which everybody was cheering when we got 16 cores, is suddenly saying, well, this is ridiculous. What the hell do I need a 16 core version of this for? Right? It was like, huh?
Well, so I think there's different voices though.
Yeah, no, I mean, but those are the loudest ones, the ones screaming at you because it's just
the ones
like,
with the headlines, Elena.
It's just a different
with the YouTube thumbnails.
And they were, right? That's exactly, and that's the thing. Those are the people again, those are the ones that are just simply the ones that annoy the hell out of me because they're just they simply exist. They're insisting that these things are stupid and never should have been made because it's not for the thing that I want. And it's like, what? Really? That's your attitude on life? And that is a really prevalent theory out there. And that is, I'm not even exaggerating that. Even Adam will agree with that, I think. So I think it is just something that is just kind of silly. It's really out there. And yeah, it does annoy the hell out of me because it's just,
yeah. I can see why you're annoyed and I just find it a lot easier just to ignore it.
Yeah, I would say specifically what annoys me is CPU for gaming. Like all the reviews just focus on gaming or like, you know, that's all the chat. And it's like, man, out of all the things to really focus on for gaming, like CPU is like one of the least ones, like for me. Yeah. Like, so like, you know, I'm not that annoyed, but also like, I don't think it's the whole PC. For me, it's like CPU. It's like, yeah, whatever.
But is that a question of selfishness or ignorance? I feel like maybe it's more based.
Both.
Well, I mean, I think it's, I honestly, I feel like more education would fix that, right? Where like, I think there's just enough people who, I mean, the same amount of people who know enough to maybe assemble a PC, and this is no slur on them. Like I was that way for a long time until I really started leaning really heavy into, you know, catching up on my tech knowledge back in the day. But it's like they're the same people who will say like, oh, do I need to upgrade my memory to improve my gaming, right? Because their focus is on games, but they don't understand how all the parts interact with each other per se, or specifically for their setup, right? So I can see why people are like, is the CPU good for gaming? Because I want the best, you know, gaming system I can have. And so they don't really realize that, well, if you have more of a lower resolution, then yeah, maybe. And if you're an e-sports competitor, yeah, maybe. But, you know, if you're just your standard person playing a single player game with a Core i5 processor, like, you'll be fine. You won't have to worry about, you know, this or that, because games really aren't making a lot of use of cores either yet. So I think it's just an education issue personally, combined with just the fact that, yeah, this is the thing I care about. So, and I don't have a lot of money, so I want to really make sure I'm making the best investment versus somebody who's like, yeah, so my company can afford to spend $6,000 on this. Which one? Okay, that one looks good. So. That's annoying. I don't have the benchmarks I need to know if I really want this one or not.
Well, I agree. It is an education thing. And that's why I often, you know, I try to communicate. I try to talk to people, because I don't, you know, I know it'd be easy just to ignore them, because you try to, like, hey, you know, look, here's some proof of why this thing exists. The problem, though, is rather than people going, oh, okay, I get it. It's just not a part for me. You just get more screaming at you. So that is
fair.
And that is kind of the problem that we've entered today, and that people just simply want to scream about it and just simply not go, oh, okay, yeah, I don't need 64 gigs of RAM for my gaming system, right? It's just kind of, the classic thing is people, you're right, people want to upgrade their, they I need more memory to play this game faster. It's like, no, you need a better GPU, you know, so.
I need the 64 gigabytes because I have 5 browsers open with lots of tabs.
Yeah. It's just part of that, that's just part of the annoyance that we've gotten to, is people just simply, they're very myopic, and they, anything else, they just have to scream and shout about. They can't accept any other different view than them. And it's kind of a problem we're in right now. So, but yes, it annoys the hell out of me.
Well, you know what the other problem we have right now is that we're hungry. Lunch? And we've been going on for almost 3 hours somehow. So we should wrap
it
up.
I'm glad I finished my work before I came.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? Podcasting's work too, Elena. You know, it's
other
important.
Work before I came here.
Gordon, take us out of here.
All right, check back next week for your fix of PC talk on The Full Nerd. For audio listeners, subscribe to us on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or Stitcher. And if you're on one of those services, please review a review. Every time you do, Apple introduces a $3,500 VR headset few people will ever buy. Think questions and comments to the full nerd at PCWorld.com. Thanks for coming. I'm Gordon Ung with Michael Kreider.
Bye-bye.
Elaine Yee.
Bye.
And Adam Patrick Murray's going to hit the out switch.
Time to go eat some food. Thanks, everybody. We have, 10 more interview videos that we did at Computex that are going up. So keep watching. Bye.